You're about to witness one of the more unique tracks in NASCAR. The Monster Mile in Dover, Delaware poses a number of questions today as Fox is proud to present the MVNA Platinum 400. And after one third of the season, these are the way the point standings fall. Qualifying rained out here, so starting position determined by points, with Dale Jarrett, your points leader, on the pole. Among the questions, can he, with his sore ribs on his right side, withstand the pain of 400 miles over the concrete? Will Jeff Gordon, just 75 points behind, bounce back from his low point at Lowe's in the Coca-Cola 600? Is Tony Stewart ready to make it three straight wins at Dover? He swept last year's cup races. Tony coming off the double-double in Indy and Carolina. And can Jeff Burton use his Coca-Cola 600 victory as a turning point for his season and for Roush Racing? The answers lie here on the track, in the high banking, and in the strength of the right front tire. A track that could be a 400-mile monster as the drivers get ready. Let's go trackside for the invocation.
Rise at this time as I introduce to you Reverend Dan Schaefer from the Calvary Assembly.
Done any better now.
For today's invocation, all rise, please.
Almighty God, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for your goodness, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. We thank you for NASCAR. We thank you for Dover Downs. We thank you for these great fans that are here today. And now we pray that we would have a great race, a safe race, that you would protect everyone that participates in this event. And we'll be careful to thank you and give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Christ's name, amen. Shalom.
Please remain standing. Now for our national anthem, I present to you country music recording star Doug Stone.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Ladies and gentlemen, now I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Melvin Joseph for those most famous words in racing.
Gentlemen, will you please start your engine?
The engines have fired. Time for our racing team to guide you through today's event. Let's go upstairs. Fox's voice of NASCAR and Mike Joy.
Thanks, Chris. Hi, everybody. With Darrell Waltrip, a two-time winner here, and Larry McReynolds, and we're concrete racing again. On this track, looks like a big soup tureen, and Darrell, it's all concrete and it's all banking all the way around.
Yeah, one of the big things about today, Mike, is you've got to communicate. You cannot come down pit road working on your car under green. So you've got to figure out what's wrong with that car, working on it under caution. You'll lose a lap here so quickly under the green coming down. If you make a bad call in the pits, Larry, you're going to go behind and you're not going to catch up.
Pit strategy, really important. But the biggest thing, you could be running along here, everything going great, even leading the race.
and you can get caught up in someone else's problem. The spotter, very important here, communicating with that driver, because you know when a car wrecks, he's going to go to the bottom of the racetrack. You just got to pick the right path to take, hopefully not get swept up in it.
To bake soup tureen, don't lose that ladle. And let's go for 400 miles around the track they call the Monster Mile. 140,000 people packed into Dover, Delaware for what's coming up next. The United States Air Force is here in force.
I'll say they shook the whole grandstand. Man, oh man.
Four-star General John Handy, the Vice Chief of Staff of the Air Force, part of our pre-race ceremony today. And quite a display of fly power and firepower there.
Ooh, that's some horsepower right there, boys.
Our butt pole sitter for this race is Dale Jarrett, because he is the Winston Cup point leader, and pole position qualifying for the butt pole was rained out, so no butt pole award. But Dale Jarrett will start in that front spot. He has three wins this year and one victory at Dover. So let's take you through, based on point standings, today's MBNA starting grid.
Three-time Dover winner Jeff Gordon starts alongside pole sitter Dale Jarrett. Gordon has redemption after last weekend's pit road miscue in Charlotte and last year's dismal Dover performances. In the last 12 Dover races, Gordon's led a total of 1,570 laps, but he didn't lead a single lap here last season. Gordon enters with plenty of motivation, and judging by the final practice session, a very fast race car. Johnny Benson, he'll start fourth in the points, finish second here in September. Tony Stewart starts in the third row, and he is the favorite to win today's race. Last year, he won both races here at Dover. In the last 2 years, he has led more laps than any other driver at this speedway. Today, he's got the same car he did all that in. He starts toward the front and is expected to run up front all day long.
And Kevin Harvick, winner at Atlanta and runner-up last week at Charlotte. My pick. Go, boy.
Steve Park, he'll start ninth. He's in the same car that he won with at Rockingham earlier this year.
And there's Bobby Labonte, and I was going to pick him, Larry, but he said I'd never work in this town again if I did.
When Jimmy Spencer was a teenager, he used to sit in these very grandstands and watch his heroes race. He made his Winston Cup debut here in 1989, but he hasn't won a race since 1994, a stretch of 214 races. Can he be a factor here today? He won the Busch race yesterday.
Elliott Sadler right there won Bristol, likes the concrete, same car.
Mark Martin coming off the top five at Charlotte last week. He's won three of the last seven races here at Dover.
Ward Burton and Kurt Busch, who picked up something in Happy Hour, making him fast from the middle of the corner out.
And Jeff Burton drive old Wilma there. Wilma, a car win again this week or not?
Jeremy Mayfield, four top tens in his last eight Dover appearances.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. still filling in for the injured Joe Nemechek, was on track to win his first Busch race before a late race accident yesterday.
And Mikey won the Daytona 500, but he needs to pick it up today. And Ricky Craven right there, he likes Dover here, had his top five finish at Rockingham.
John Andretti on a mission, missed the race last week, second fastest in practice yesterday.
Mike Wallace has two top tens this year, and Kevin LePage makes his seventh Dover start.
Casey Atwood coming off a hard crash at Charlotte last week, he's still looking for his first top 10 finish this year.
Brett Bodine's a former pole sitter on the Monster Mile.
And Todd Bodine's had a fast car on a number of occasions, hadn't had very good luck. Maybe today's his day.
Hutch Strickland, he finished fourth here in 91 and 95 in that 90 car. It won the race here in 1981 with Jody Ridley.
And Kenny Wallace makes his 16th start at Dover. The NASCAR qualifying procedure meant the drivers with few qualifying attempts this year. Lance Hooper, Rick Mast, and Dave Marcus. Jeff Green, drivers down in the points like Kyle Petty, did not make the show here.
But Jeff Green, that team will be in Michigan next week to make this race up with that RCR car.
43 car field, 48 cars were here to attempt qualifying, and they go 400 miles, exactly 400 laps.
Pit window, 85 to 95 laps. A lot of teams said, we'll probably let somebody else try to do that. We're hearing that NASCAR will possibly throw a caution somewhere around lap 40 to 50 just to let the teams check their tires.
Got to take care of that right front tire. Really load it up here. It's hard on the tire. Get that air pressure too low, trouble.
We'll have lots of onboard cameras. There's our Brady Bunch screen of onboards. Eight of them for you today.
Look at Rusty up there. I love to watch Rusty. He's got all the moves. He's snapping that wrist, working that shoulder. He is a hyper driver.
He never quits moving.
He never quits moving. Look at him. He ain't ready yet.
You know, his youngest brother, Kenny, is just as hyper as he is. And Mike, he's the calm one of the family.
Yeah, he laughs at them, too.
There he is. Getting ready.
Yeah, look at
getting
him.
Getting ready.
All right. I can't. Now over here, got to tighten that up. We'll get wiggle around. Do it again. Hot thing. Here we go.
If he was a pitcher, he'd balk at just about every throw.
He kind of looks like Chris Myers in a helmet.
Yeah. See, there you go. He's talking to you.
All right, I'll buff them tires off. That's something else I got to do here. Put that visor up. All right, now I got to slap it down.
Leave the man alone.
Here we go.
Here we go.
I love Rusty. He's my hero. He's the man.
All right, DW, I tell you every week, but I'm going to stress it here. Pull them belts tight. 400 laps, 400 miles.
Yes, sir. Here we go. No passing until you cross the start-finish line. All passing to the right. And we're going to go boogity, boogity, boogity.
A 15-year-old junior flagman at the base of the stand. He's got a flag in hand. So does the starter. We're racing at Dover. It's going to be a fight for the lead off turn two, won by Jeff Gordon.
Boy, yeah, not much of a fight. Gordon just flew by on the outside and is checking out.
Got a good run in that high groove off turn two. They'll run around the bottom, and they'll try to get that upper groove to come in just as soon as they can. Johnny Benson in the 10 car, he's working on it already.
Jeff Gordon has now led 12 of his 17 Dover starts, and he's led 12 of the 13 races this year.
And boy, right now is tense time. You got to hang on that bad boy because he's going to be a little
trouble in one.
Here we go.
Two cars in the wall. Bill Elliott's one.
They ain't done yet, Mike.
No, sir. They're coming to the bottom of the racetrack.
They're going
to
come down in front of you. You better be ready.
Kenny Schrader all torn up.
I'm just saying, man, you got to hang on to them when the first few laps here because they're really loose. And there's Michael. Crashed. Bill hits the wall again.
Bill Elliott in the 9 car. Jerry Nadeau in the 25 car.
Strong contender. Nadeau is good in practice.
We talked about it in the opening. One car's problem. End up 6-7 car's problems.
The first few laps of all these races, tire pressure down, track dirty. Man, you just got to hang on to it. Look at that. Nadeau knocked the whole right rear out from under that thing.
It's still got the axle and everything hooked into it.
We broke the housing right off.
We may see trouble in front of Elliott. And the first car loose may have gotten away here. Let's see. There's Elliott, the red car on the outside.
Elliott down in the corner.
It's Nadeau down on the flat.
Nadeau's going around. And here comes Bill Elliott trying to squeeze by on the outside. That ain't going
to
work.
Nowhere
to go. Schrader right into him. And then here they come down the track. Whoa.
This is where Casey Atwood and the 19 car gets hit in the side.
The 9 and the 19 get whacked into this deal.
Michael Waltrip's wild ride.
Stay on low. Come on. Watch it now.
They come to the bottom of the racetrack.
Boy, I mean, it just looks exactly like what happened to Michael in Charlotte when Jeff Gordon came down the track in front of him.
Riding with Casey Atwood. Oh, and he catches Nadeau.
Just don't know where to go.
Lap three, and we'll stand silent to the memory of Dale Earnhardt. Jerry Nadeau climbed out of his car and walked away. But for Ray Evernham, who grew up not far from Dover Downs in New Jersey, this is his home racetrack. As you watch Nadeau walk away, both of Evernham's cars are badly damaged. And Kenny Schrader has another tough one unfold right in front of him.
Didn't even get his water hot.
Bill Elliott and Casey Atwood's cars both badly damaged. We're under caution early as the Monster Mile's appetite is apparent.
The MBNA Platinum 400 brought to you by MBNA, issuer of the official NASCAR credit card. Log on, MBNA.com. By Valvoline MaxLife, the first motor oil formulated for higher mileage engines. By Budweiser, with the crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer, this Bud's for you. And by Midas, whether it's exhaust, brakes, or just an oil change, when it comes to total car care, Midas, we do that.
We're under caution, and here's why.
Yeah, Nadeau just got, he got down into turn one, got down on the apron, and that just turned him around.
It upsets a car when you let those left side wheels drop down on that asphalt.
Exactly.
Nadeau, Schrader, Michael Waltrip, and Bill Elliott are in the garage, and the Monster Mile has already become a concrete cruncher.
Cruncher.
Monster Mash.
Cruncher.
What's happening here?
How my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise, Monster Man. It caught on and flashed. It hit the monster from my laboratory in the car police to the master bedroom where the vampires feast. The ghouls all came from their humble abode to get a joke from my electrode.
They did the match.
They did the monster match.
The monster match.
It caught on and flashed.
They did the match.
They did the monster match. The zombies were heavy on. Party had just begun. The guest included Wolfman, Dracula, and his son.
To Dover, Delaware, currently under caution here. And this reminder, Friday, the Winston Cup qualifying on Fox Sports Net, 3 Eastern, 12 Pacific. And then on Saturday, the Arca race at 4 Eastern time and the final tune-up. They call it happy hour. You'll see that on FX. And then next Sunday, NASCAR this morning on Fox Sports Net at 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific. And the Winston Cup racing on FX from Michigan. Tony Stewart, your defending champ, and NASCAR Victory Lane back on the net to wrap things up. Jerry Nadeau causing the caution here on the second lap. Let's go down to Matt Yocum. He's with one of the guys involved in that Monster Mile mash. Matt?
Chris, right now, Michael Waltrip just walked up and is talking to Bill Elliott as Elliott's crew works in this number 9 car. Bill, what happened?
Looked like the 25 and the 26 just had a little altercation there, and I just got caught up in the aftermath.
Well, they're trying to fix this race car. And Michael Waltrip has walked away. We'll catch up with him. And Jerry Nadeau has just walked out of the infield care center. And we'll talk to Jerry in just a moment.
So everyone is okay, but there is a lot of damage to these race cars.
And what's so bad is, not only is your car wrecked, they're going to fix it. And they got to get back out there and drive that thing all torn up like that. And that's no fun for a driver. That's when you start saying, anybody like to get some seat time?
But you know, Darrell, it's 9 laps of 400. Again, points.
Oh, yeah.
You
got to get back out.
Get back out there and gain 3 spots, then it's worth the effort you put into it.
Now, Casey Atwood has pitted every single lap for repairs, but he's managed to stay on the lead lap because he gets out of the pace of the pits before the pace car comes around. We're under caution, but we'll be back.
Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by MBNA, issuer of the official NASCAR credit card. Log on, MBNA.com.
Welcome back to Dover. We're half a lap from going back to green. We've run 11 laps. Jeff Gordon has led them all, but caution early when Jerry Nadeau got down on the flat and went to the wall, taking Bill Elliott, Kenny Schrader, Michael Waltrip, and Casey Atwood with him.
Yeah, it kind of reminded me of Indy, you know, when the early start there, those guys were getting down below the white line and was kicking them loose, and it's a little bit cool today, I guess you could say, and these tires are a little harder than maybe the guys would like, particularly on these restarts. So, and the track's a little bit dirty from cars riding around here all morning.
Kevin Harvick in the 29 car, he's coming to pit road here if we get the green flag.
He must think he has a flat tire. He wouldn't be coming down pit road now.
But he'll lose a lap changing it as we are back under green, and Harvick hauls along at the pit road speed of 35 miles an hour. These cars out there come out to 150 or so miles an hour.
Oh, it's murder to make a pit stop under green. You're going to lose a lap and a half at best. There goes Gordon by, and Harvick still in the pits.
Right side tire change for Kevin Harvick. Rusty Wallace passed Jarrett into second. Remember Dale Jarrett in the 88 playing hurt. Those injured ribs from his Charlotte qualifying crash.
And like any injury, Mike, you know, it's going to take a little time for him to loosen up in the car. I'm sure they worked on him. Take a little while for him to get comfortable in the car. Get a little heat in that body and in those injuries and get to going here, and that competition will take some of that pain away. What he doesn't want to have today is another accident. Oh, trouble off of turn two, guys.
And
turn two.
Big one.
It's a big one, piling them up left and right. Jimmy Spencer.
It was Spencer and Ward Burton.
Ward Burton.
Kick it off. And almost everyone else got on the brakes, slowed up and gone. There's the damage to the rear of Burton's car. And Kurt Busch, the rookie, is part of it.
Down against the inside wall. We can't see him from up here where we are, but he's down on that inside. It's so narrow off of both of these corners, off turn two and off turn four, that if anything happens, there's not a lot of room, not a lot of places to go.
This keeps up, there won't be a lot of cars and it won't be as much a problem, but my gosh, early on in 15 laps, two big caution flags.
Jimmy Spencer six was loose. Now we'll maybe get another angle to see if he actually got a little bit of help.
I couldn't tell. It looked like he just got sideways up off the corner. I don't see anybody.
Oh, Mark got a piece of it there. Got into the back. That's what got
into
the back of Burton.
There goes the 97 into the wall, inside wall hard.
Kurt Busch, 97, just nowhere to go. Car spins on him, hits the wall. He's the last victim to get involved with the most damage.
And again, the self-cleaning banking. The bank's all the way around. Everything's going to end up at the bottom.
Spencer just looks like he gets loose up off of two. And, folks, it's real dirty back there. There's an opening in the fence back there where cars come in and out of the racetrack. And It's dirty when you get the race started early here.
Kurt Busch hopping over the fence.
Yeah, he says, my motorhome's right over here, and I'm going to it.
Now, they're trying to get him to the ambulance to go to the care center. That is a requirement. He's saying, I'm okay, I'm just mad. And they said, no, you got to go get checked out.
That's mandatory. If you're in an accident, as aggravated as you are and as upset as you are.
Now, they're working on Jimmy Spencer and Mark Martin because Martin was the car that ran into the back of Ward Burton as Burton was spun. It's damaged to the left front of Mark's car. Dick Bergeron?
Well, Mark Martin's car is really in tough shape right now. Sean Parker is looking underneath it while one of the other crew members is pounding on the left front fender, trying to push it back up again. Let's go to that.
Well, Jerry Nadeau is watching his crew work on this 25 car. Jerry, what happened?
I don't know. It was pretty frustrating. I mean, it's early in the race. I had a run on Jimmy down the backstretch, and he started coming down. I let him go, and I had another big run on him on the front stretch. And like they say, the guy that never forgets obviously forgot I was underneath him. I went in turn one, and he just pinched me right down to the bottom. I got my left side tires on the apron, and I got into his door and spun out and took a bunch of good cars out. We had a car to win the race. I hit it for UAW Delphi. I see he got in a wreck on the backstretch. Just a bad deal.
This has been a very tough racetrack for Jerry Nadeau. In five starts here, four DNFs, three due to accidents. They're going to try to fix this race car, but it looks pretty bad.
There's Nadeau's crash, taking out Elliott, Ken Schrader, Michael Waltrip, and damaging Casey Atwood's car. That was lap three. Then at lap 15, this damage to Jimmy Spencer's car as he spun and took Ward Burton, Kurt Busch, and Mark Martin, and it looks like also Bobby Hamilton Jr. got a piece of that one. And it looks like Spencer's going to climb out. Here's Matt.
And Jimmy Spencer climbs out of his wounded number 26. Jimmy, what happened?
I just got hit from behind, you know, for no reason. Too early in the race for that to happen. I don't know who did it, but just hit me in the left rear quarter panel and spun me out. Just stupidity.
On the early incident with Jerry Nadeau, he felt like you pinched him down.
Yeah, you know, I heard that he was underneath me, you know, and I mean, I really thank Jerry for what he did there. I really feel bad about that, you know, but I don't think I gave him the room he needed without a question, but I did not need that to happen to my car either, you know. I didn't pitch nobody down. They just flat run over my ass. That was not right.
We already have six cars out of this race. Jerry Nadeau, Michael Waltrip, Ken Schrader, Bill Elliott, Kurt Busch, and now Jimmy Spencer.
My theory for Dover, you come here, you stay on the lead lap, you don't make mistakes, and you'll have a good finish, DW.
Don't make a mistake. That's the deal.
Getting set for the restart, you see Kevin Harvick to the inside of Jeff Gordon. Harvick had that green flag pit stop for tires, and he's going to try to get back on the lead lap. Half a lap back, Jeremy Mayfield, who made a late stop for fuel.
He had a flat right side tire before that last restart. He came back and got four fresh tires, wants to get that lap back.
He's got a car good enough to do it, too, I believe.
And his tires are 20 laps fresher than Jeff Gordon's, and there he goes.
And that will pay off big time if this thing happened to stay green for a little while.
Rusty Wallace trying for the lead on Gordon, turn three. Not going to get it there.
This place, Mike, is notorious for riding around under caution. And when you go back to green, you think you have a flat tire because you pick up all that debris and rubber on these hot tires, and the car will vibrate and shake around, not feel good for you, and you'll think it's flat. Sometimes it takes two or three laps to get them cleaned up.
Here's Matt and Kevin Harvick's pit.
Well, as of right now, he didn't get his lap back, but this is what Kevin Harvick had to pit for. This is his right rear tire. He ran over something under the first caution and punctured this tire. He did come back in and take on four tires, but this is his right rear tire, and that's what's giving this team an early setback, Mike.
Wallace again looks for the lead out of turn two to the inside of Gordon. He's got room this time.
There is no race car out there today that's any faster down the straightaway than that two car is. That thing boogies down that straightaway. I saw it at California and I saw it at Charlotte. He's doing it again today.
Since California, Wallace has led each of the last six races. Here's Gordon right back by him.
No time to fight. Got the position. Let him go. He'll get him back.
For more on Rusty, here's Steve Byrne.
Well, Mike, Rusty said his car is turning very well, but it's turning just a little bit too well. He's loose off the corner, and Rusty's already talking about what changes they're going to make. They're going to add air to the right front and put one round of fight in when they make their pit stop.
Darrell, you got to be so careful here. As the race goes on, a car will normally get tighter and tighter and tighter just because of rubber going down on the racetrack.
Yeah, you'll start off real loose, and that's what's happening to these guys when we had these early wrecks. Cars are really loose for about the first 10 laps. Then all of a sudden, when you're complaining loose, you start complaining push.
25 laps complete this time. Mike Skinner and Bobby Hamilton battling for 10th. Skinner edges ahead.
He was the fastest man in practice yesterday. Mike Skinner in that 31 car had a good car yesterday, got in a wreck with Bobby Hamilton Jr. with a few laps to go, but he was very happy with his race car when I talked to him this morning.
And this place is one of those places, Mike, where if a guy gets a nose, if he gets a fender right along your left rear, man, you're just not sure if you need to let him go or not. 90 times out of 100, if you cut down, you're going to wreck.
Bobby Hamilton back at 13th. Dinner Friday night, he started tossing crab shells, Darrell, when you said you were going to pick him to win.
Yeah, I picked him three times. He blew up twice and spun out once. He said, please, leave me alone.
Talk about me, but
talk
don't
about
pick
me, but don't
said.
Pick me.
This is looking out of Bobby Hamilton's car, looking on to Matt Kenseth right there in the 17 car.
And he will be at the front. He will be somebody to deal with before this day's over. If that car gets around here, he and Tony Stewart. And I give a lot of credit to Doctor Who for that.
The shock man, Doctor Who.
The shock doctor.
Not as in electrical shock.
Shock absorbers. That's what's important here on this concrete. These tires, they build up a lot of air pressure here, probably more than any place else we go. I've seen them build up as much as 22 pounds in the right front tire from the way you start the tire off. And that really creates havoc for the driver and the team. Thing gets bouncing like a basketball.
Bounce. Now, Darrell, in IndyCar racing, they have bleeder valves. If the pressure exceeds a certain amount, it will bleed off that excess air pressure. Would that technology work here?
Oh, that'd be a beautiful thing on one of these stock cars. But our friends in the red shirts don't think that's such a good idea.
The NASCAR rule book says it's not legal. Now, we do all the things that we can do, like we purge our tires with pure nitrogen. Nitrogen don't expand as much with heat as regular air compressor air. So we do all we can, but we cannot run bleeder valves.
And it wouldn't be such a bad thing because you wouldn't have to start the tire pressure so low. That's when you damage the tire. You damage the sidewall of the tire when the pressures are real low on them in the first few laps. But you don't know it from a driver's perspective until something happens.
Jeff Gordon has flamed out to a 1.7 second lead over Rusty Wallace, Dale Jarrett, Ricky Rudd, and Sterling Marlin. There's Marlin battling with Johnny Benson for fifth place.
And it seems like that Harvick is able to kind of keep Gordon at bay, and that's probably both of them being a little conservative. Now, Harvick's not conservative. I take that back.
There's the gap, first to second. That's a lot of lead in very little time.
Yeah, it is. Considering everybody else is pretty bunched up here behind him. That's what you want here, is to get some laps down, get into a rhythm, and start communicating, as I said, just like Rusty was doing, telling that team, here's where I am right now, lap after lap. That's what you got to do.
So what these teams are doing now, we are on the longest green run that we've had so far. Remember, NASCAR, they're going to let these guys get about 40, 50 laps on their tires, and they're going to throw that mandatory caution. Now, I think it's going to come later than lap 40 or 50 because of all the caution laps we've run. Simply a chance for these teams to look at those tires, make adjustments.
Well, you know, in some series, Mike, they have what they call a competition yellow. I believe we ought to have that. When there ain't no competition, we should have a yellow.
They are saying about lap 55 to 60, somewhere in that range. And again, if they're going to put a competition yellow on the field, they want to do it so that it doesn't disrupt the competition. So that's why, instead of committing to a specific lap, they have a range of where they might throw that caution. Jeff?
Mike, I'm just wondering right now, the guy who looks like he's going to benefit from that mandatory caution is going to be Kevin Harvick. But I'm wondering if Jeff Gordon is after him, trying to get him so he can put him back down that lap before the caution comes out, seeing how strong he is, because if he doesn't, he may have to contend with him later on in the day.
I don't know, fellas. If you're Jeff Gordon, are you racing the racetrack or racing Kevin Harvick?
You're racing the racetrack right now. That's one car. You don't ever really want to focus in on any one particular car. Harvick gets back on the lead lap. Guess where he has to restart? About 40th.
Well, we got a battle for second right here. Dale Jarrett in that 88 car, bringing teammate Ricky Rudd in the 28 Texaco car. They got Rusty on the high side right here going into turn one.
And that 28 car, Larry, is a car that everybody, and me included, thinks got a good shot at this race today.
Remember, Rusty said his car's a little bit loose. He's going to lose about four or five spots here. Man. Steve Park in the one car, Mike Skinner, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Tony Stewart in the 20 car.
Well, he's lost eight positions.
But listen, here's why. Look where he is now. There's nobody in behind. There's a big gap here between he and Bobby Labonte. So if his car's a little loose, gives him some room to play here and a little bit safer position to be in.
Definitely keeps a car off of his rear bumper. This is what he wants to see out the back of his car if you're loose, because, Darrell, when you're loose, someone up on your rear bumper, it takes that rear downforce away, will make you even looser.
Yeah, fall in behind these guys and wait till you get in the pits.
So that's the backup plan, backing up to a clear space on the racetrack.
That's a good plan.
Dick Martin was one of those damaged in the last 15.
Martin's event is one of the pre-race favorites, but he surely has had his problems involved in that second accident. He made three pit stops, during which time they changed the left side tires, beat the left front fender up. Mark said that the steering wheel is off-center just a tick. You know how they lined up the front end? Jimmy Sedick just stood there in front of the car, looked at it, and said, "Looks all right, Mark, get out of here." So Mark Martin was racing with less than a perfect race car.
Now, a lot of times we'll line the front end up with a straight. Oh, 92 car high in turn four here. Looks like something happened to it. I'm not sure he didn't cut down the right front tire, and that's one of the things that they're worried about, is right front tires.
Compton slow and now down around the bottom of the racetrack, but he's got to go three-quarters of a mile before he gets to pit road.
It couldn't happen in a worse place. Just past pit road entrance, and I'm pretty sure it's a right front tire failure.
Looked like the right front tire was down when we looked at the right side of that race car.
And he's got to be careful getting it back to pit road. He doesn't come apart and tear the car up. The tire is so mean, that radial tire, it'll tear a fender right off the car.
There we go.
Right there when he wiggled. Car just, boy, that's as close as you can come to hitting the wall on the exit here and not hitting the wall.
Stacy Compton makes it to pit road for a change of right side tire. We're under green at Dover with 41 laps complete. This is NASCAR on Fox.
The MBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by Subway, showing the world how great a fresh sandwich can taste. Subway, eat fresh.
47 laps complete at Dover. Stacy Compton made that stop for right side tires, but left with the wedge adjustment wrench in the rear window.
And Mike, that's what I was saying in the opening. You can't work onto your car under green. You don't have time. It puts too much pressure on everybody. You can't be putting spring rubbers in, jacking around on that thing. Gas and go. That's all you can do.
So he's now several laps down. This week on Fox Saturday Baseball, interleague action returns. Chipper Jones leads the Braves into the house that Ruth built to take on the world champion Yankees. Or Troy Glaus and the Angels battle the Dodgers. Or you'll see other regional action beginning Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern and Pacific. Check local listings for the game and start time in your area.
And our last week's winner, Jeff Burton. I mean, he is just about ready to go a lap down.
Yeah, they were not very happy with their car yesterday. I talked to Frankie Stoddard this morning, his crew chief. He just kind of shook his head. It's like they went from the penthouse to the outhouse in 1 week. That's the thing about this sport. It's a humbling sport.
And let me tell you, I don't know what they did last week. I don't know what car they had, but that's the one I'd be running this week.
Well, I asked him, and he said it is not the same car they ran last week, and I just kind of looked at him.
Yeah, me too.
It was Mark Donahue who made famous the saying, Sunday at midnight, the clock turns back to zero.
How about this 20 car, Tony Stewart, Home Depot car? Won both races here last year. He's all the way up to fourth, and he's the only car that's really even close to Gordon. And actually, he's a little bit closer. Matt Yoakum, they're on the move.
After winning both races here last year, that you would not pencil in Dover as one of your test states, but that's exactly what this 20 team did. They had a feeling the bump stop rule would be coming down the line, so they came here and tested without bump stops. Had to change his line slightly. They also had to make some changes in their setup. Right now, early going, Stewart says the car is loose in the center, tied off, and now the car is starting to come to him. They're going to make some adjustments on this first round of pit stops, anywhere between lap 55 and 60.
But I don't disagree with that philosophy for two reasons. And I always, you know, people think you go test places where you run bad. But if you run good, you know the competition's always working. Go in there and get a little bit better. Don't hurt things. Plus, also, with the new tire, this could be a place to Tony and to Greg Cipollone, his crew chief. How much has the package changed from last year? So two reasons, I think, behind testing.
See, you're the same way I am. Why do I want to go somewhere and test, waste a taste of work, a test where I don't run good? The heck with that place. I'm going to go stay good at the track I know I can win at.
And get better.
I used to go to Martinsville all the time. They said, what do you want to go there for? Because I want to be sure I keep winning there.
Good point. For more on last week's winner, here's Dick.
It's a short story. Jeff Burton's crew thinks he has a tire going down. They're going to leave him out there as long as they possibly can, Mike.
Well, and we're lap 53. Again, you don't want to take a chance and blow a tire, but they know that competition caution to check tires is going to come. Where right now, if he pitted Darrell, he'd be almost three laps down.
Oh, yeah, you just go to lose so much time. Two laps, pretty close to two laps, pitting under green. 35 mile an hour down that, all the way down pit road. It takes forever.
Tony Stewart underneath Sterling Marlin, and that's third place.
And the car looks really nice. It's right around the bottom. Doesn't look like he's fighting with it at all. One of the few cars is staying right on the bottom.
For more, here's Matt.
Greg Cipollone, Tony Stewart's crew chief, just radioed and told Tony to try to get around the 40 car of Sterling Marlin if you can before we pit, because Marlin's pit stall is right before ours and will help you on your exit.
I mean, the pit stalls are so tight here. I mean, it is a tight pit road. And the thing about it, he wants to be sitting in his pits before Sterling gets to his. He don't want to have to go around him to get in his pit. So that's a great theory if your car's good enough to do that.
It is, and you want to work with the guys around you. I think that's something you can probably talk about, Larry, is how you negotiate, if you will, with the pit crews around you so you don't end up getting in each other's way.
And you can see the pit stalls right here on the front stretch. I mean, it is very, very tight. Yeah, there's been places like here in Martinsville where I'd go to a guy and say, hey, wouldn't it make a whole lot more sense if you let us by to come into pits first? I think it'll benefit both of us.
And the crew chiefs always say it makes sense. Here we go with that yellow, I believe.
And that is the competition yellow that we expected for the teams to be able to check tire wear. And it comes out at lap 58.
Mike, again, just to reiterate,
This is from lack of practice, not really a lot of time on the racetrack. And it's just for everybody's own benefit. This doesn't help anybody, doesn't hurt anybody, and everybody gets a chance to look at the tires.
It benefits one guy, Kevin Harvick, in that 29 car.
You know, he had bad luck, so it just offsets that for him, if you will.
Got a great Tony Stewart story as we wait for them to come to pit road. You talked, Darrell, at the top of the show about how important communication is. When his crew chief, Greg Zipidelli, met the woman who would become his wife, it was in a very noisy environment, not a racetrack. She says, where are you from? He said, Kensington. She goes, where's that? He says, near Hartford, Hartford, Connecticut. She says, oh, and what do you do for fun? He says, I'm a crew chief. She went home and told her girlfriends that he lived in Kensington House at Harvard. He went to Harvard, and he was the head of the rowing team. They recovered from that, and they're now married.
And so, she married him anyway.
Good communication eventually.
All right, 31 cars on the lead lap, and all of them are coming to pit road, four tires, making those adjustments. Dick Berggren. Well, Johnny Benson's car is pushing a little bit, and they're going to try and get that push out. There's no surprise that they're having a bit of a chassis problem here. They could not get through inspection this morning. They had a little bit too much camber in the rear end. NASCAR made them fix it. To Steve.
Well, Dick, Jeff Gordon said he's just a tick loose, so they're going to drop air pressure just a bit. Todd Gannon, Shane Church, changing tires. Look at them back.
The 20 car and the 40 cars, Tony Stewart and Sterling Marlin pitted right in front of each other. A track bar and the adjustment on the 40 car, he's down, the 20 car's down. They made an air pressure adjustment, and there's a loose tire on pit road. It's flipped up over the wall.
Johnny Benson hit that tire, and that's one of the fears of this pit road. There, it may not be done yet. It's coming back across pit road, but you get tore up more on pit road here either by a car turning out on you or a loose tire, and it's still moving around on pit road.
All those tires are marked with the car number.
The interesting thing is nobody's going to claim that.
You see all the damage to Johnny Benson's right front. He's going to have to come back to pit road.
Oh, that's it's like hitting a deer.
Johnny Benson through with his pit stop. Everything good.
He doesn't see it because the 28 car, watch the 28 car move.
Zig.
And when he does,
zag.
Hello.
Oh, you just saw it just kill that right front fender.
You even saw it. I think it hurt the right front suspension, too, because the right front tire really shook when he hit it.
That's what you talked about at the top of the show, Larry, getting caught up in someone else's mistake.
Yeah, I mean, that's like hitting about a 40-pound piece of block of rock or ice or something. I mean, a lot of damage, and front fenders are so important here because of front downforce, and it's going to – we seen it last week at Charlotte on Jeff Gordon's car.
What happened to Jeff Gordon last week.
Let's see where it came from. It might have been – well, I won't speculate. There it goes. That's right behind, I think, Sterling Marlin's pit.
See, these cars start to see it here. Mike Skinner in the 31 just getting by. Ricky Rudd got by it. Johnny Benson didn't see it, as you said, Darrell, because of Ricky Rudd.
He pulled out to miss it, and Benson had no idea that it was there. Bam.
It's one of the great things about either qualifying good here at Dover. Of course, we didn't have qualifying this week. Is being high in the points to get a good pit spot. Should it get rained out as it did here, get it that end of pit road.
Well, Benson was fourth in the points, but apparently they picked a pit that was further up pit road. They did. They picked a center pit to try to get an empty spot in front of them. It was a good call, but here it cost them.
It bit them. Yes, it did. I got to believe they want to bring that back to pit road. He's back on pit road now. They're going to have to fix that. And you even see that little white thing dragging underneath. What that is, that's one of the blowers for the brakes to cool the brakes.
So Johnny Benson, the latest victim of the Monster Mile. Watch what happens to the right front tire of Steve Park's car.
Tire's coming off right here. He rolls it in, and somebody's supposed to catch it. One of the crew members should have caught that, but they didn't, and here she comes.
Back across pit road. And the real rule infraction here is the fact that before your car can leave the pit stall, all the equipment, including both tires, has to be back across center line of your pit box toward the pit wall.
So Steve Park is penalized to the end of the longest line for the restart. Another loser on pit stops, Rusty Wallace, came into the pits 11th and came out 28th.
I bet you they did a lot of work to that car. He was loose. He probably took spring rubbers out. And here we go back to green, guys.
Mike Wallace in that 7th car. He'd like to get his lap back. He's in the 32nd position right now. 31 cars on the lead lap.
Gordon Stewart, Marlin, Skinner, and Jarrett, the front five.
I wish Mike Wallace well, but he's going to have to muster up a lot of steam to get around that 24 car.
He's got other problems with Tony Stewart, that Home Depot 20 car behind him.
Yeah, well, he can stay there for a lap or two, but if he isn't able to go on, then he'll have to start moving over, letting these lead lap cars go. And that's what you fight all day here, being a lap down.
Boy, Johnny Benson off the pace at the back of the pack after running into that tire from Steve Park's car. Here's Dick Bergeron.
Well, Johnny Benson is really having his problems, Mike. They wanted to put this little piece of fascia on the front of the thing. They didn't have time to do it. He's got a flat tire now. Benson is going to be coming back in and change that tire.
Mike Wallace has bounced off the wall here on the front straightaway. Jim Smith, number seven, seems to be okay.
Yeah, he was just, you know, like they say, up on the wheel, trying to get all out of that thing he could to try to stay up there and get that lap back, but I think he overdid it.
Well, we just had a heck of a battle for second place here. This is Mike Wallace now.
Ooh,
got loose,
man.
Jumped back in the throttle. Darrell overdriving his car, trying to get back up there, stay up to get his lap back.
Yeah, that's what that was all about. I mean, give him an attaboy for trying, but...
And Mike Skinner has gone to second.
Talked about the battle for second. Mike Skinner in that 31 car, he started deep in the field, had a good run yesterday in that Busch Grand National car. I think the Busch team, the 21 team he's driving for, and that group, the 31 team, they're really working close together.
Benson is in for that repair Dick talked about, and a right front tire. Dick?
Well, they're at least going to try and get the right side tires on. He did call in and say that one was going flat. They have had very little luck trying to get this car the way they want. Right now, they're trying to pull the brake ducts off it so they're not tangled up with the wheel. Almost nothing has gone well for these guys since the drop of the green flag.
Well, Dick, Rusty Wallace did make some major adjustments on the last stop. They added 2 pounds of air in the right front. They put a round of bite in, and the time-consuming factor was they closed off the right front shock, and that affects the compression. Matt Yoakum.
Walt Smith is a pit crew coach for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated and also the Jackman on the one car. Walt, what happened with the loose tire?
It started off as a halfway decent roll, and unfortunately it hit the hose and veered to the right just a little bit, which caused the guy at the wall to miss it. It got back out, and a car coming into the pits hit it. And so NASCAR gave us a stop-and-go penalty for it. It was one of those freak things, and now we've got to just regroup the guys in the front, make sure that they calm down, and don't let it happen again.
Ricky Rudd moves past Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Dave Blaney has come to pit road with what may be an oil leak. And there may have been contact between Ricky Rudd and Earnhardt Jr.
We're looking at Dale Earnhardt Jr. in that Budweiser number 8 car. Talked to those guys this morning. Even up to about an hour and a half before the race, they were still making changes on that race car. Went to a lower gear here. Felt like the race pace was going to slow down enough to justify it. They was changing A-arm links. They were still making changes very close to the start of this race.
Well, looking at the lap times, Larry, that is considerably slower than we normally run here. That's a middle 24-second lap. We usually run low 24-second laps here.
And I'm sure that's contributed to a lot to the harder tire, not as much grip.
Earnhardt Jr. right back underneath.
After the 8, it begins 5.
See that? Yeah, you see that little dent, if you will, in the left rear of Dale Jr.'s car. Here's how it got there.
Coming down the front stretch, a little bump right there.
And what that is all about is communication. Now, Dale Jr. wanted Ricky to go by on the inside, but he didn't know that. Dale Jr. lets up a little early, and Ricky gets into his left rear. Just a lack of communication.
You don't want to bump nowhere, but if you got to do it, the middle of the straightaway, just stay in place.
Oh, yes, yes. Going down into these corners, go down in there so fast. If anything happens, the drivers can't react that quick.
Jimmy Spencer has gone to the garage area, victim of the second wreck, and the 36 of Ken Schrader is back in the race after repair. A look at Ricky Craven's race. From 30th, he dropped back 6 spots and then started marching toward the front.
Jeff Gordon now 1.6 seconds up on Mike Skinner, and another second back to Tony Stewart. Then Sterling Marlin, Dale Jarrett.
You know, Gordon said last week in Charlotte, all that was wrong with his car was that right front fender. You know, we talked about what his problem was, and that messed him up all day. Let's see if we can get down. Man, I need to get in one of these babies. Let me see if I can get down in. Oh, here we go. Here we are right down in there with Dale Jarrett. Coming by the start-finish line. They're doing about 165, 70 mile an hour. Down into that corner, and then left wheels kind of clip that apron getting in there. Shove up just a little bit, back wide open right here. Watch that wall when you come off it, too. You get mighty close to it. Little bitty short straightaway, and you're right down in the corner again. Again, left wheels down on the bottom. Slide up in the middle a little bit. Back in the throttle wide open, and it gets real loose up off of that corner. Back to the start-finish line. That's a fast lap, folks.
In a mile. One mile.
And you do that 400 times.
Time and time again. And every time you come off a two and four, you're never sure if it's not going to bump that wall. Traction here, grip here, hard to get all day long.
Bit of heavy traffic here. Elliot Sadler, Mark Martin, and Ward Burton, the 22. We want to say hi to Bill Davis, who owns Ward and Dave Blaney's car, had kidney stone surgery and got rid of the stones, but ended up with some kidney damage, and he's resting uncomfortably still in the hospital up in High Point, North Carolina. So, Bill, one of our favorite folks in the garage. Hope you're back soon.
Yeah, and Blaney was on pit road there a minute ago with problems, and the 33 car, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Nemechek's car, something wrong with the engine in it, and they're pushing it to the garage.
Yeah, he's got, we're hearing he's got a cracked cylinder head, and that won't work this early in the race. You see the water running out the exhaust pipe.
Well, did you see the grill opening? If we get a shot back at the grill opening of that car, there might be a good reason why.
Yeah, that happened in the second accident of the day, Darrell, at lap 15.
And look in there. What I was seeing in there, you got an aluminum box behind that grill opening that directs air to the radiator. A lot of that ductwork is missing, and the radiator sacrifices a lot of airflow because of that.
And a driver, as focused as you are and as quick as you go around here, you don't watch the gauges every lap. You just look at them every now and then. And you'll be riding along, and all of a sudden the crew will say, hey, look at here, we got a race for second place. All of a sudden the crew will say, how's your gauges? You'll say, they're fine. Oh, no, they're not. You look down and you say, man, my water temperature gauge is pegged.
Mike Skinner running the high side off the corner. Tony Stewart, that 20 car, he's right on the bottom. That's the way around this racetrack. You know, Tony Stewart, we've talked about his success last year. He's never finished worse than fourth here, and this is the same race car he has run all four races with here.
It's just such a great run through the center of the corner. That's the beauty part about running a low line. You just get through the center of the corner so much quicker.
Sterling Marlin right back in the picture after a good pit stop. He is in fourth place right there.
And Dodge better be glad that that 40 car is out there, because that has been the banner week in and week out for the Dodge brand. That 40 car with Sterling at the wheel and Chip Ganassi with the ownership is doing a great job for that, for those guys.
He's just a little bit quicker than the leader, you see by his last lap speed there.
Boy, and he is. The car is handling great. He's diving that thing off in the corner, getting a great run up out of the corner. Car looks good.
They were not very happy with this car in final practice. A lot of changes, as on a lot of race cars in the garage area this morning. Tony Glover said they changed everything on it but about one spring.
Fastest car on the racetrack is Kevin Harvick. As we complete 85 laps, he got his lap back and is working his way back up through the field, the 15. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
NBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by New Havilland Motor Oil Technology, formulated for improved gas mileage. Add more life to your car. By Miller Lite, grab a Miller Lite. It's Miller time. By your neighborhood 7-Eleven store. Oh, thank heaven for 7-Eleven. And by Napa Auto Parts. Napa, we keep America running.
Jimmy Spencer is back in the race after repairs. 91 laps are complete. Jeff Gordon has led 90 of them. Rusty Wallace out in front for one lap as Dale Jarrett gets past Mike Skinner for third place.
Yeah, that was a good pass there by Dale Jarrett. And, boy, Sterling is really, he's catching Jeff Gordon. We'll have a race for the lead sometime here before too long, but that's a great pass getting around Skinner.
Jeff Gordon in the 24 car. It's the same car that he won with at Las Vegas, won that $1 million bonus.
He got a lot of cars he could say that about, I think.
I guarantee.
He won five of them. And Dale Jarrett, on a couple of these laps, he has been the fastest car. Darrell, for a fellow who is playing hurt, you look at the way that 88 is running, you'd never know it.
Yeah, I think he got to pace himself, you know. He don't want to use himself up early in the race. And what are they saying down there, Matt?
Well, about six laps ago, Darrell, Bob Jeffrey, who is Dale Jarrett's spotter, came on the radio and said, DJ, the 32 car Craven and the 29 car Harvick have moved up to the second groove, and they're the two fastest cars in the racetrack. You might want to try to adjust your line. Dick Berggren?
Mike Skinner's problem is that his race car has gotten loose on him. Every once in a while, he comes over the radio and simply says the word loose. His crew chief, Roy Spagnee, has just told him, don't worry, we'll tighten it up for you on the next pit stop. Easy for him to say, he's not driving the car.
Oh, don't worry, be happy. Same thing happened to the 20 car, I believe, Larry. He was running longer. I believe he got loose. He went up high down there in turns one and two, and he's backed up a little bit. So some of these cars are going loose now.
He's starting to run the high groove right here, but the boy I'm impressed is Ricky Craven in that 32 car. He started 30th. Remember, we heard Bob Jeffries, Dale Jarrett's spotter, say he had moved to the high groove. He's already up to six. Go off in turn three right here. He's about second groove up right there. Tony Stewart, though, loose race car, a little higher may be better.
Yeah, it will be. It'll give him a little more room to operate. More on Ricky Craven. Here's Matt.
Ricky Craven is one of the fastest cars in the racetrack. He's following Tony Stewart, who, as you mentioned, Larry Mack, has been battling a loose race car. He's had to adjust his line, trying to find out what these Goodyear tires need. Right now, he says today they're a little bit unpredictable, trying to find out what he needs to do to take that car right to the very edge.
Remember, at Rockingham, Craven started 41st and finished 5th.
Yeah, the old TIDE car is running pretty good today, Jessica Lee.
Talk about fast race cars, though. Remember, a lap down because of having to pit for right-side tires before that first restart. Restarted in 30th. He's all the way up to the 13th position. He's working on Todd Bodine in that 66 and Ron Hornaday in that 14 car. So, again, they let him have his lap back, but wonder what's going to happen late in the race.
I don't know, but he's digging, I can tell you that. He likes to come from behind. He likes to make up laps and be dramatic.
Well, they've caught Ron Hornaday. Hornaday started 35th and got all the way up to 10th, and now he's given back a couple of spots, battling here for 11th with Harvick.
Yeah, Harvick's done a good job coming from way back on the restart, and he just slowly and surely working his way back up to where he started when the race started.
Car really working good on the bottom. It's the first Winston Cup car he drove back at Rockingham in February, 1 week after Dale Earnhardt's tragedy in Daytona.
And what a schedule he's got. Not only is he running all the Busch races, he's running all the Cup races, and he started a truck team. He wants to run a couple of truck races and then run Rick Pirelli next year in his truck if they get a sponsor.
When you got it, baby, flaunt.
Go for it.
What a phenomenal season he could have here. I mean, realistically, he could win the Busch National Championship. He could win Winston Cup Rookie of the Year, and he could easily finish in the top 10 in Winston Cup points. And what a feather in the cap of his owner, Richard Childress, to have won a Winston Cup championship, a Truck Series championship, and on track to possibly win a Busch Grand National championship.
See, a guy that looks to me like he's picked up the pace a little bit. I believe some of that painkiller might have kicked in now, and he's ready to go racing, is that 88 car, because he is coming after Charlie Marlin as they go back into the third turn there. And Dale's car looks really good. He's moved up a little bit. Well, come up off the bottom and it's helped him.
When you're hurting, Darrell, what's the best painkiller you can have?
Oh, for that thing to be driving good.
Good handling
and running good.
And that's the car that he ran last week at Charlotte. Also, it's the car that he won at Texas and Darlington with as well. He likes this race car, so I'm sure it always makes him feel good.
And I tell you, that poor guy that just struggling again today, and they're going by him left, right, Jeff Burton. I mean, he can't even get up to Harley race speed.
And he's not the only fella in trouble, Darrell, as we look at the speeds at the line. Lap speeds at the line. Jarrett quickest. No, Craven quickest. As we Craven cycle down through.
Craven is the good
Kevin Harvick. He's on the move.
Another of those fellows in Steve Park,
remember.
No, Jeremy Mayfield.
The further back you go, the faster you are.
They're getting drafted. They're the other fellows assistants in trouble.
Rusty Wallace restarted 28th, and he's only gained four positions since.
He's only about 5.5 seconds from going a lap down, Steve.
Yeah, Mike, they made a big adjustment. They closed off the right front stop. And what they want to do in the next stop is take this spring rubber and put it in the right front of that number two car of Rusty Wallace.
Now, what they're talking about is closing off the right front shock. Yeah, we can change things internally about a shock, but they also have an adjuster on it. And what they have done closing it off, they've had added compression, the part of the shock that closes up. The stiffer you can make that, the tighter it will make the race car, help the looseness he's been fighting. Now, that's not enough, Darrell. They want to put that piece of rubber to stiffen that right front spring.
And you know, these cars will, at a track like this, sometime will react totally different than you expect them to. You close that off, think that's going to tighten you up getting in. Actually makes it worse. Kind of holds that corner up, makes the back end come around as you enter. Then you're too tight off because you got all that compression in the shock and you're sliding the nose. So loose in and tight off, that's big problem here, what you fight most of the time.
Absolutely.
Jeff Gordon's lead over Sterling Marlin now 1.8 seconds in the MBNA Platinum 400. Dale Jarrett, Mike Skinner, Ricky Craven now the top five. Jeff Gordon leads by 1.9 seconds now over Sterling Marlin, Dale Jarrett, Ricky Craven, now up to fourth, and Tony Stewart fifth. Here are two fellas trying to stay on the lead lap just in front of Jeff Gordon.
Robert Presley in the 77, Hut Strickland in the 90, beating and banging, but as you said, Mike, desperately trying to stay on the lead lap.
You can get a lot more side bite with eight tires than you can with four, and that's kind of the proof that's there.
This 29 car, that Goodrich car, Kevin Harvick, he goes by Dale Earnhardt Jr. That's for the ninth position. He's back in the top 10 after being a lap down right at about 100 laps ago as we're at lap 114.
And there are some guys that are in, whoa, where's Jr. going here anyway? There's some cars that are in jeopardy, good cars. Rusty Wallace was leading this race earlier, and he's in jeopardy of going a lap down here very, very shortly.
John Andretti, that 43 car, he second fastest in practice yesterday. Talked to those guys on Friday, missed the race last week. They said, look, we come here on a mission. We're going to qualify good. Of course, qualifying gets rained out, but we are going to work on this race car, and we're going to be there at the end of this race.
Second fastest in happy hour
yes,
yesterday.
Sir.
He's got a little damage to the nose up there. That might be hurting him a little bit.
Ward Burton trying to stay on the lead lap.
Boy, he's in danger. There's a 10 car going a lap down, and Rusty is just ahead of these guys. Best thing Rusty's got going for him is that these guys hold him up a little bit, hold Gordon up a little bit. Maybe Rusty can get away far enough that Gordon can't get to him for a while.
25 cars on the lead lap after just 116 miles.
Boy, there goes the 29 car right around the 28, and we know Ricky Rudd got a great race car. That's what Larry told me.
But look at Harvick. I mean, he's been doing this all day long, right around the bottom of this racetrack. When your race car can do this deep into a run, you're going to be good.
You're going to be good. And Larry, that's him. You sure you're not tapped into him? Because that's about what they're telling you.
So Harvick up to eighth, and he begins to close on Terry Labonte.
But you know a guy that's having, a good race is Terry Labonte in that Kellogg's number five car. But something surprised me. He's competed in 44 races here. But in the last 23 starts, Dover's not been good to him. Only one top five finish. Another thing that kind of surprised me, he's the only driver to compete in all the races this year that has not led a lap. I'll
tell you a quick Terry Labonte story. We were running here. I was running terrible, about like Burton is. And Terry Labonte came on the radio and said, how many 17 cars are in this race? And they said, only one. He said, why? Because I've been passing 17 every 10 laps.
Oh. Second place race. You're riding with the Coors Light car of Sterling Marlin, the Dodge. Here comes Dale Jarrett, speedily delivering that package into second place.
I ran so bad here one race, Mike, that Eddie Dickerson, who is from this area, worked for me. He quit on Monday. He said, I can't go there and be embarrassed like that anymore.
Dover can turn you against right.
This way it will humble you.
Johnny Benson in the 10 car, his troubles continue. He's back on pit road for more work.
This time it's the left side. Jeff Gordon leads, Dale Jarrett, Sterling Marlin. Fourth place car will be Ricky Craven.
Not for long. Tony Stewart kind of got her tightened back up. I think he's about lost that thing down there in turn two earlier. Took him this long to get his confidence back.
For more, Dick Bergeron.
Well, Ricky Craven had motored all the way from 30th spot to 4th, which he has just lost at this moment. But he radioed just before this happened to his crew and said the car is perfect. Then he asked if they could start building more cars just like this one, like maybe tomorrow morning. Craven delighted with the performance of his race car, as he well should be.
One of the things about that Cal Wells team is they build their own cars. They build the chassis and everything themselves. And, you know, maybe that's not one of those in-house cars. That might be one of those old Hopkins cars or one of those old Laughlin cars. Because in-house cars can get you in trouble.
Yes, they can. And, you know, I've asked the question, why would teams build in-house cars? One reason they do it, Darrell, is just controlling it a little bit better. Controlling the weight of it, controlling the pivot points. But he's losing another position here to Mike Skinner in that Lowe's 31 car. But just getting some more consistency. But sometimes going back to that old Hopkins or Laughlin car, builds a lot of chassis in Winston Cup, not a bad plan.
Yeah, a lot of guys think they got to have a custom-built car, which I agree with. That if you get a customer car, it could be the same car that everybody else gets. But always look at what's beating me. And what's beating me week in and week out is one of those Hopkins or one of those Laughlins. 10 car is back in, and it looks to me like he is headed for the garage.
Rusty Wallace has now dropped to within just a couple of seconds of being lapped by Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, he's looking in his rearview mirror right now, and what he's seeing is not making him happy. That's what happens to you here. You make a minor adjustment on a pit stop, a little air pressure the wrong way, a shock adjustment the wrong way, and you get lapped.
Well, and remember, yes, car is not to his liking, but lengthy pit stop, lost a lot of track position. That don't help either.
Johnny Benson has taken the Valvoline Pontiac to the garage as we complete 125 laps in the MBNA 400.
MBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by MBNA, issuer of the official NASCAR credit card. Log on, MBNA.com.
Fastest cars on that last lap, Dale Earnhardt Jr., third quickest, Steve Park, second fastest, and a young fellow in his first Dover appearance, Jason Leffler, fastest at the line, but Jeff Gordon leads Dale Jarrett and Sterling Marlin. Jarrett by 2.5 seconds and Marlin by 3.5 at 131 of 400 laps.
And being fast at the end of a long run is a great thing if you haven't lost too much time. That's what you really got to look at, is how fast am I at the end of a run, but then you don't want to give up so much that you get so far behind it doesn't do you any good.
Right now we're at lap 132, so in the next 20 or 25 laps, if should we stay green, we'll be seeing green flag pit stops. So these teams really interrogate that driver right now. They're telling them, the longest run you've had, what have you got?
I look at Marlin, the third place car, now 4.4 seconds off of Jeff Gordon, and he's about a second ahead of Tony Stewart, who sits fifth. Mike Skinner's the sixth place car. He's 2.5 seconds behind Stewart. And he has Ricky Craven all over him. Then it's about 7 tenths back to Kevin Harvick. And a similar gap to Terry Labonte, Steve Park, right there up Labonte's tailpipe.
Yeah, and Harvick and Steve Park both had to restart on this last caution all the way at the back. Whoa, man.
And just remember the reason Steve Park had to restart back there on that last caution that NASCAR threw about lap 60 is because they had a tire get loose and they put him at the back of the longest line to restart.
But Walt Smith explained they roll that tire to a man who's behind the wall. NASCAR limits how many men can go over the wall as Park passes Labonte. And the tire hit the air hose, never got to the wall for the man to catch it. It bounced off the air hose and out into traffic.
Yeah, he's supposed to catch it. And my old man was, I'm sorry, guys, but the 90 car almost hit the end of the pit wall down there coming in the pit.
Yeah, NASCAR, they don't really want to know the problem. They just want to know the solution.
Right. Well, with Benson out of the race, he came in here fourth in the point standings and eventual engine failures, but put Benson out after running into that tire from Steve Park's car and damaging the aero on the front end. So that will shake things up here in the Winston Cup point standings. Ricky Rudd and Tony Stewart have a chance to capitalize.
Boy, you just never know, Larry, what your day is going to be like. You start a race and everything's good, the car's good, you're driving well, you're happy. Something happens on pit road, of all places.
If this place will do it to you, we see more situations occur on pit road here probably than anywhere we race.
And that's one reason why the speed limit on pit road is only 35 miles an hour, but it doesn't seem to make any difference.
Jeff Gordon lapping Buckshot Jones. Remember, Gordon's sponsor headquartered just up the road in Wilmington, Delaware. They always bring a lot of folks down here, and they always expect this car to run real well here.
And everybody there is a race fan. You can believe that.
There's teammates, Mike Skinner in that 31 Lowe's car, Kevin Harvick. Kevin Harvick just continues to pick him up. This is a battle for six.
And guess what? Skinner will not move over and let him go by without a fight. We saw that yesterday in the Busch race. Coming to the checkered flag, they were banging on each other.
And Steve Park's going to be part of that battle, too.
Now, Harvick in the 29 and Park in the 1. I believe they've had problems early, but they knew, their race teams know they've got good, fast race cars, and I think they're proving it.
Bobby Labonte not having a great day here. Although his teammate Tony Stewart's won the last two in a row here, he slides up the racetrack, and here comes that hot rod rookie.
Boy, I'm impressed with Jason Leffler in that 01 car, and this is a battle right now for 14th. Jason Leffler in the 01, he started 38th, but his crew chief, Matt Chambers, he won the truck race here last year with Kurt Busch. You notice a little different paint scheme. His sponsor have put this paint scheme on there as a strategy for 4 years to raise $40 million for the Special Olympics.
Wow. What a great Rusty. Rusty Watson just getting ready to go a lap down. Gordon is all over the back of him, and I know Rusty's giving it all he's got, but it ain't going to be enough.
They need the wings back on that car, Darrell.
That thing run good, didn't it?
I like that paint job.
It was a pretty paint job. I
like the way the car ran, mostly. And here comes Gordon underneath. Gordon 3.5 seconds up on Jarrett when he caught Wallace. Let's see what battling Rusty does to that lead. It goes from 3.44 seconds.
Oh, they're going to hold him at bay because there he goes. He cleared him that time. He didn't clear him off at two, and he couldn't. He had to have the whole racetrack when you get down on the bottom.
And that cuts Gordon's lead from 3.44 on that lap, only about a tenth of a second. Here comes Park on the bottom.
Two fastest race cars, Steve Park to one, Kevin Harvick to 29. This is a battle for seven.
For more on Steve Park's march to the front, here's Matt.
Michael talked a lot about bump stops being outlawed. Steve Park was one of the drivers that competed on a regular basis with bump stops. 90% of their testing this year have been with bump stops. So now they're using Steve Park's Busch program with Teddy Marsh as a test bed to try to get a little more up to speed on the older stuff. This is the same setup that Park competed yesterday in the Busch race and finished in the top five. Very close to what they had yesterday, so they know what they need to do to this race car as the run goes on and the race progresses.
Yesterday, Steve Park, for much of the day, was the fastest car on the racetrack. Ron Hornaday, Buckshot Jones, scheduled green flag, set stops. Kenny Wallace is in, Ward Burton is in, Mike Skinner's in with Steve Park.
I think this is about the right time to pit. What do you think?
Yeah, it's about 80 laps into a run, so it'll be about twice the length that they run a while ago, and we're going to probably see everybody start coming to pit road. Jason Leffler in the 01, he's on pit road.
Boy, Skinner ought not be too happy with his pit stop. How about it, Dick?
Well, Skinner is in a little bit earlier than he had anticipated. He thought they were going to go a few more laps, but he just came on the radio and said, wow, peeled off the racetrack, came in for four fresh tires, and maybe a little bit more speed. Come on.
Steve Park is already in. They're going to work on the left side of the car. No chassis adjustments on the one car apart. He is down and away to Steve.
And Jeff Gordon has just radioed and said, guys, I'm still just a tick loose. Robbie Lewis said, bring it in here. We'll get four tires. Gordon not yet on pit road. The crew is ready for him. Now Robbie Lewis saying, come on down. Counting him into his pit stall. Gordon slides on the left. Chris Anderson is the jack man. Jeff Craven will put the gas in. They do make a wedge adjustment to the right rear of the number 24 car. Now left side tires coming off and tires going back on. Good stop for the 24 of Jeff Gordon. 15.5 seconds, Matt.
The leader, Dale Jarrett, on pit road. The early portion of the race before he pitted on lap 58, he was very loose in the center of the corner and tied up off. Now he says his car is just the opposite. It's tight in the center of the corner. As he comes to a stop, Mike Trower goes to work on the right front. Darren Jolly rolls the tire back across. No chassis jumps. They pull the tear-offs off the windshield. They will adjust this race car with air pressure. DJ's down and away.
as the 20 car is also coming down 60 even seconds to the 40 car Sterling Marlin. Tony Stewart, the Rushville Rocket, gets a little burst of speed as he comes into his pit stop, barely makes it inside the box. Remember, the black line on pit road is the outer edge of the pit box, not the concrete. Some drivers were penalized in the Truck Series race as they make a chassis adjustment on Tony Stewart's car. A little bit of trouble on Lester, 16.3 seconds. Nick Burgess, Ricky Craven in for a four tire change. They're going to take a half a pound of air out of each of the two right side tires. That is the only chassis adjustment that they are going to make to this race car that has run so very well all day long. Craven, gone. Great stop.
Mark Martin is also in. Dale Earnhardt Jr. coming to pit road. Bobby Hamilton finishes his stop.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, the Budweiser car, he had inherited the lead through these green flag stops, led a lap, and then he come to pit road. Steve Burns.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr., he comes in behind the 6 of Mark Martin as Mark exits pit road. Right side tires, Cody Urie James Jr. changing the right front tires. No chassis adjustments thus far to the number 8 of Dale Earnhardt Jr. Jeff Clark, the Jackman, underneath the left side of the Budweiser Chevrolet. Left side tires on. 15.6 seconds for Dale Earnhardt Jr. on pit road.
That should cycle us through the cars on the lead lap for pit stops. It'll put Jeff Gordon back into the lead by about 2 seconds.
And right there behind him is Rusty Wallace, who did make some changes. He's hanging a little closer now, but I still don't think he can handle Gordon.
He's hanging on for a caution.
More than a third of the way through, 153 laps completed. Dover Downs in the MBNA 400 on Fox.
The MBNA Platinum 400 brought to you by AutoTrader.com, the biggest, best used car site on the planet. By Kellogg's, the official breakfast food of NASCAR. And by the motor oil that provides the most protection, Castrol GTX. Drive hard.
Welcome back to Dover at 160 laps coming up. Jeff Gordon, our leader over Dale Jarrett and Sterling Marlin. There's our 7-11 pit stop summary under the green flag.
Well, we've talked about this a lot this year. Now, what this is 2 laps, including the pit stop. Sterling Marlin, looks like his group not only did a good job on pit road, he did a good job getting to pit road and back on the racetrack up to speed.
And boy, when you got a good race car and you're running well, everything goes well. The driver does his job, the crew does their job. Big rewards. The other side of that coin, boy, Jeff Burton, last week's winner. This week, here's an unscheduled stop. Or did they get off sequence with their pit stops after Burton went a lap down?
I think they just come in to work on it and put some tires on it. He's really struggling out there.
Goes past Kurt Busch, who's back in the race after being involved in one of the two big accidents of the day. Busch in the one on lap 15.
Yeah, Jeff Burton being shown in 31st position right now.
Gordon coming up on Matt Kenseth, who was battling Jeremy Mayfield a couple of laps ago. Now, they were 16th and 17th, but here comes the leader.
But you know, Mike, Larry, when you win a race, that's why you better enjoy it. You better celebrate. You better get all out of it you can, because you never know what the next week's going
to
be like.
It lasts about 3 or 4 hours to get back to the shop the next day.
About the time those guys came down off the fence, the thrill was gone. They started thinking about this week.
And Matt Kenseth, for whom Dover is one of his favorite racetracks, struggled in final practice yesterday in the one-hour practice. And Jeff Gordon's about to gobble him up.
Yeah, in three out of four Dover races, he has finished 6th or better. This is a brand-new car, new Hopkins car they brought here, Darrell. And was one of the strongest cars yesterday. Put a lot of that setup, but he's fixing to go a lap down right now. He's in 16th, 17th position.
This long green flag run has put a number of cars a lap down. Gordon, 2.6 seconds up on Dale Jarrett. There is the gap, first to second. There's second place Jarrett. It's another 2.5 seconds back to Sterling Marlin in third. And from Marlin, it's 5 seconds back to this man, Tony Stewart. Matt?
Mike, all day today, Tony Stewart has been reporting his race car starts out very loose at the beginning of a run. It takes almost the entire run to work his way back up. So on this pit stop, the reason why the 16-second change, they pulled a spring rubber out of the left rear and also went one round down the track bar to try to tighten this race car up a little more at the beginning of the run. Dick Berman?
Well, yesterday, Mike Skinner finished fourth in the Busch Grand National race here at Dover, Delaware, but he came into the racetrack this morning feeling mighty glum. He was involved with an accident with Bobby Hamilton Jr., took himself out of competition to win it, took Hamilton out of the race. Some of the people in the garage have blamed him. Skinner was hanging his head. When he just pitted, they adjusted the car today to try and tighten it up. It wasn't enough. He has just come over the radio and said, we need to tighten this car up, and about four exclamation points. Steve.
Well, Dick, a little while ago, he said that Rusty Wallace's crew wanted to put a spring rubber in the right front spring, but as Darrell Waltrip said earlier, you just can't do that under a green flag pit stop. It takes too much time. So what they did was put two rounds of bite in the right and take a pound out of the right rear. So, again, not enough time to put that spring rubber in the number two car, Rusty Wallace.
We've been 108 straight laps under green, and that has really shaken things out.
Yeah, you might be able to put a round in the track bar or a little around the wedge end, but most of the adjustments that need to be made under green are with air pressure. And you might say, you know, you got to do, normally to make a car good, Tony Stewart made two adjustments, track bar down and a spring rubber out. Spring rubber out of the left rear, track bar down, that's going to tighten him up, getting in with the track bar down. And then the spring rubber out of the left rear is going to help him turn in the center and come off. So when you can do combinations of things, that's when you really are making some good changes.
Fifth place battle's a pretty good one. Picks up right where it left off before pit stops. Kevin Harvick and Steve Park. Now they're running 14 seconds off the lead, but they're pretty close together.
14 seconds, that's over a half lap down.
But right now, Kevin Harvick, he's about 3/10 quicker a lap than our leader, Jeff Gordon. So he's in good shape here. I mean, we're not even halfway right now. But Darrell, the thing I'm hearing that's a little surprise to me, Dover, Delaware, you always think about the car pushing, not turning as the race goes on. But I think this harder tire, and this is a hard compound tire because it's the same tire that the team ran at Atlanta a few months ago. I think that's causing these cars not to grip, especially in the rear of the car.
Yeah, I think you're right. And again, this track is notorious for tire buildup. Again, you can build up over 20 pounds of air pressure in your right side tires. You get a little bit too hard a tire, this track's a little slick, and that buildup, and buddy, you've got your hands full.
Now back behind Park, Ricky Rudd is about a second and a half back of Steve Park, then Mike Skinner and Todd Bodine in the top 10 for the first time today.
And Mike and Larry, I've been more uncomfortable here than any racetrack I've ever raced on. The speeds are high, the concrete doesn't give you the feel it has the grip in it, and you never feel like the car is getting in the track. It always feels like it's just up on top of the track, slipping and sliding around, and you don't know which end's going to break loose first.
Wow. Looking back at Mike Skinner from Ricky Rudd's Texaco Haviland onboard camera. They are 7th and 8th.
And again, that relates to a shock package. Here you want a lot of bleed in the shock. You want the shock to really work, let the chassis work. And things that they do to shocks is what makes the difference at this racetrack.
Todd Bodine has only one top 20 finish since he was 5th at Las Vegas in March. He's up in the top 10.
And he likes this place. He helped me here last year when we were here for the fall race and actually ran pretty well. And he likes this place, run goodly in the Busch car here. This team has had a good car on a number of occasions, but they've had terrible luck.
Yeah, started way back in 39th position, and unlike about a dozen other drivers, normally we hear Todd Bodine will run the Busch Grand National race on Saturday. He did not drive that double zero car. The car owner, Buckshot Jones, run it yesterday.
Riding with Casey Atwood in the Evernham Dodge that was damaged in the lap 3 accident. And sliding up the track, John Andretti, and Jeff Gordon shoots on past Andretti and Jeremy Mayfield, putting them both a lap down.
I think the racetrack's going away from John Andretti in that 43 car. He was good at the beginning of the race, was marching toward the front, was fast yesterday in practice, and here he goes a lap down. But I'm just wondering if the racetrack's going away from a lot of the cars, even though we talked earlier that this concrete surface is not as sensitive to air temperature changes. The track temperature, we started today 85 degrees here at lap 176. It's up to 90 degrees. The sun's out. It's making this racetrack a lot slicker.
It does. And once it gets slick, again, the car just never feels like it's getting any grip. The front's pushing too much. You turn the wheels hard left, and all of a sudden the back snaps out. Money, here we go, snapping out Money off a turn four, eight car.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., that Budweiser.
Hang on to her, buddy. Hang on to her. Fight her to the bottom.
Okay.
Nice
save.
Job. Save. Woo. Well, you don't have that happen very often.
No, you don't. Very rarely, one car accident.
Well, he was all by himself, and he just come up off of turn four. And I believe a lot of these cars have got way too much right rear spring in them. That's what's making them loose.
It puts us under the fourth caution of the afternoon at lap 177. Dale Earnhardt Jr., a single car spin coming up off turn number four.
And that saved a bunch of fellas from going a lap down. They needed this caution desperately.
Mark Martin in particular in that sixth car.
And the big losers on that one, John Andretti and Jeremy Mayfield, who had just been lapped by Jeff Gordon.
And Jason Leffler as well in the 01 car, who was having a great run, still having a great
still
run,
is.
But he's a lap down.
Boy, Junior's coming in the pits. He has no choice. He's got tires down, but it's going to be hard for him to get in and get out without losing a lap.
16 cars on the lead lap, counting Earnhardt Jr.
Both right side tires are flat.
Let's have a look at what happened.
He's just all by himself. He comes off here and the thing wobbles a little bit with him, gets a little wiggle in her. But listen. Nothing but tires crying, Larry.
That's what you want to hear.
No
here if it's
crunch.
Gonna happen.
No crunch.
You don't want to hear that concrete crunch.
All of our leaders about 30 laps into this run. Caution's out there on pit road. Four more tires.
Boy, and pit crew did an awesome job. They got him out just in front of the pace car.
Steve?
Well, Mike, four tires for Jeff Gordon. His only problem is, he said, when he gets behind other cars, he gets a little bit tight. Of course, he's been passing most of them, but now left side tires going on. We got a Dick Berggren.
Ricky Rudd is in the pit right now, going to get four tires. Norman Kujimizu just turned into the round edge in the car to try to tighten it up. To Matt.
The 24 car in the 88 will lead everyone off here. Rodale Jarrett said the last set of tires turned the car a little bit to the loose side, so they did not make any adjustments. Too worried that this set of tires might be a little bit more extreme and really mess up the handling on this car. So no adjustments for the 88.
Of course, Jeff Gordon, 24 car, he's going to win the battle off pit road. Talked about his car being a little bit tight behind cars. You lose the front downforce. The air pushing down on the front end, and hadn't been a big problem for him today except lapping cars.
Yeah, right. I'd like to have mine that bad. A lot of people like to have his problems. There's the luckiest guy out there right now. Spun out, didn't hit anything, came in the pits just ahead of the pack and got out before he lost a lap.
He's going to be back on pit road to finish up the work and finish up the tire change.
Whoa, look how close he got to that outside wall.
Oh, roof flaps come up on it.
And he never gave up on it, Larry. He kept gassing, braking, and he saved that bad boy.
Earnhardt Jr. remains on the lead lap, 180 complete here at Dover. Fox welcomes you back to Dover, Delaware, the track called the Monster Mile, and they did the MASH as we recap early on the second lap. Multi-car accident created by Jerry Nadeau on board here with the Michael Waltrip, and you see what he saw. And Bill Elliott, Casey Atwood, a couple of Dodges taken out in a hurry. Second caution, Jimmy Spencer involved in a multi-car wreck, Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, rookie Kurt Busch, he got the worst end of that right there. And they're coming up off the four. See Mike Wallace getting into the wall. He continued. And the latest caution came from Dale Earnhardt spinning off of turn four. But fortunately, they got control. Roof flaps did their job, and he got her back across start finish line.
All right, and the latest caution helps out a couple of guys trying to get some laps back.
Yeah, you see Jeff Gordon come to the line right there about the middle of your screen, and right underneath him, right in the last second, the 12 car of Jeremy Mayfield beats him back to the line by just a nose to stay on the lead lap.
As we continue to take a look at the race from our new sign at the Hollywood Hotel that was donated by some of the people here in Dover. They like to watch what we watch as we bring you closer to the race.
Well, Grady.
Always have a great spot. Jeff Gordon is looking good in more ways than one, not only leading the race, of course, and has led all but seven laps so far, but he has been nominated, the three-time Winston Cup champ, by GQ Magazine as Man of the Year in their sports category. Others include people like Lance Armstrong and Phil Mickelson and Andre Agassi, so something for Jeff to think about. And he has been golden on this track, three consecutive wins when you go back to the fall in 95, 96. And as Larry McReynolds pointed out, he's the same car that he won in with Las Vegas, but coming off a down week, and it's rare for him and his crew to have back-to-back shaky weeks.
As I was trying to tell you all afterwards, that whenever these guys have a bad weekend, they always come back the next weekend with a vengeance. They either come back and get in the top five or they win. So when those guys have a bad race like he did at Charlotte, we'll be under the competition, especially coming to Dover.
All right, let's go down to Steve Burns, who is track side. Steve?
Well, Chris, earlier today, Matt Yoakum said that 24 team and Jeff Gordon, they're looking for redemption. Redemption because they did not have a good week in Charlotte, but also because although he's won three in a row here at Dover, he has not won since 1996. On this last pit stop, they made no changes to that number 24 car, just put four tires on it, didn't even adjust air pressure. Matt?
Tony Stewart hit pit road in fourth and left in fourth. Tony and Greg Zipidelli had a conversation right before Tony came down pit road. They made the decision to go a little bit more to the extreme. They'd rather go a little bit over trying to tighten this race car up than not make enough because they're losing too much time. So they made two rounds of wedge in the left rear, one round down of track bar to Dick Berggren.
This sport will humble a man for sure. Last week, Jeff Burton seemed invincible at Lowe's Motor Speedway where he won the race. Today, he could barely hang on to his race car. They have just made a lengthy pit stop in which they have adjusted the track bar an inch. They took the tire off and adjusted an inch. They adjusted the alignment of the rear end an eighth of an inch. Four tires, four rounds. Let's go to Mike.
Dick, only four cars officially out of this race. Johnny Benson with engine trouble, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Bill Elliott and Michael Waltrip are out.
There's some guys half out, though.
You don't wish they were out.
They're riding around there with half a car.
Trying to ride and get a few points. Now, here's Dale Earnhardt Jr., who did not lose a lap with that spin off turn four.
Good work by his crew.
Oh, great. You know, he had flat tires when he came in, just ahead of the leaders there, or just ahead of the pace car, and they got tires on that thing, got him out before he lost a lap.
They're putting Matt Kenseth in line. He tried to race Gordon back to the line, came up a little bit short there, so they'll get him in line for this restart, Jeff. Back there in a moment. Only three drivers have ever won three in a row here at Dover. We mentioned Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace did it in 93 and 94, and David Pearson back in 1972 and 3. The Silver Fox took three in a row from the Monster Mile.
Tony Stewart at Home Depot car, he'd like to add his name to that list, Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, Larry, I wanted to make sure that the folks at home understood that when Jeff Burton came down, what they had to do is on the left side of the car on the track bar, they have holes, little serrated plate holes, and they're able to slide the track bar up and down on the left rear. It's not got the jack screw like it does on the right side where the guys can adjust it outside the car. So they had to unbolt it, drop it down 1 inch, and re-tighten it back up so they could get the track bar lower to get that forward bite up off the corner. And
you don't
need to go green.
Yeah, you don't adjust the left rear track bar unless you're in real trouble. Let's crank it up one time, DW and Mike.
Here we go.
Skinner, the man on the mission, looking for redemption after sliding up into Bobby Hamilton Jr. yesterday, knocking Hamilton from the lead and the race in the Busch Series event. He moves past Ricky Rudd, and Skinner's up to sixth.
You hear him kind of pedaling that throttle up off the corner, Darrell. You got to get back in that corner, way back before the center of the corner. But sometimes the car just won't take it. You got to drive it with the steering wheel and the throttle pedal.
Yeah, they start to push just a little bit. And you got to squeeze up out of it to get the thing to set down and take a bite. That's why you do that pedaling. The guy that pedals the best, obviously, is out front. People at home wonder what are they talking about pedaling. These things got no pedals.
Yeah, it's not Lance Armstrong.
They got pedals. They got three pedals down in there. What you got to remember is which one's which.
It's our words for working that throttle.
Yeah.
Sterling Marlin again has his hands full with Tony Stewart.
And again, a combination of changes on that 20 car. When they took that rubber out of the left rear, in order to get their percentage of wedge back in that car, they've had to crank down on that spring because that spring became much softer with that wedge out of it, or with that rubber out of it.
And not far out of that picture is the white 29 of Kevin Harvick, and Skinner is coming.
Teammate in tow, the 31 car.
All that 31 car needs is a little incentive like that in front of him. It seems to step him up a notch.
It's like the rabbit on the Greyhound track.
Yeah. The one in the front saying, no, you can't. The one behind saying, I think I can.
You know, a guy we hadn't talked about a whole lot today. This is looking out the back of Bobby Labonte's car. He's looking at his brother, Terry Labonte, in that 5 car. But he's in the top 10 now in 10th position, started in 12th. This is a fairly old car. It's the car that he won the Southern 500 with. And looking at Terry Labonte on June the 20th in Corpus Christi, Texas, where these two brothers are from, they're going to rename a park. The Terry and Bobby Labonte Park.
It's a great honor when your city, so you know where you grew up, you go back and see all your old friends, high school mates.
Darrell, do they have a stack of speeding tickets in Owensboro that they've named after you?
You know, just when I said that, I thought, you know, it's good that you can go back to your hometown when you everybody doesn't have that luxury.
As long as they don't name a jailhouse.
That's right. The jailhouse.
Tonight on Fox Sports Net Beyond the Glory, you're going to want to see the story of Michael and Darrell Waltrip, and they're growing up in Owensboro. That, check your local listings, but that is a great show, and one that I think will hit the heart of all of our NASCAR fans, especially those with a little bit of a heavy foot. It's on tonight at 8 p.m., but check your local listing on Fox Sports Net, the Waltrips on Beyond the Glory.
We were just a little young and restless and foolish, I might add.
No, he's led a lot of laps, but he's got a mirror full of that UPS car right now, Dale Jarrett. I believe they've been adjusting on that old Ford, and he's getting up there right in Jeff Gordon's rear bumper.
Really getting into the corner well. He's actually beating Gordon down in the corner. Gordon looks like a little bit better off the corner, but things are looking ups right now for him.
That was very punny. Tony Stewart on the move. Moving around, Sterling Marlin. This will be for third place. Tony's hammering away at it, if you'll pardon the pun.
Yeah.
Ward Burton in the 22 car out there, he's a lap down. Remember, he was involved in that accident on the backstretch earlier.
Boy, Harvick right back there, and he just came off turn two over there, and the car took off just a tad with him. He had a really lift. Skinner closed right up on his back bumper, but caught his breath, and here he goes.
He's closing right there. That's a little bit too fast for the center of the corner right there,
yeah.
Kevin.
Up again down there. It seems like he's having a little trouble in turn two. Boy, these cars, from up here, it's just so incredible how fast they enter a corner. 170 miles an hour on a mile racetrack. That's going down in that corner like riding a roller coaster.
And it's hard to see how steep 24 degrees of banking is here. But if you look at the edge of the grandstand, it's banked at about the same angle, and that looks steep.
It is steep. This is a very fast one-mile racetrack. A lot of intense driving takes place right here.
Got a battle for seventh right back there. That's Steve Park in the one car. Ricky Rudd, that 28 car.
And we are halfway in the MBNA 400.
And there, when this thing was 500 miles, that was about the most depressing thing you could see. Was that halfway mark. He's like, what? You're only halfway? I thought this thing was about over. Watch how fast these things get down in the corner. See if we can get a mile per hour reading here. There's 166. About 166 miles an hour on a one-mile racetrack down into a 24-degree bank turn. That's hauling the mail, folks.
J. Jeff Gordon has led all but seven of the first 200 laps. In fact, I think only one driver, Rusty Wallace, has led a lap under green besides Jeff Gordon.
And this would be a good time for one of those where are you now or we are here or you are there.
He is checking out.
And we're two laps past halfway, so just a handful more laps here, about seven more, he'll clinch up the bonus for leading the most laps.
But he's got his adversary in his rearview mirror, and that ain't no package truck.
Right now, he's about a tenth faster than Dale Jarrett in the 88 car, so here comes that one car, though, Steve Park. He's going by Mike Skinner. This is a battle for six. Remember, Steve Park went to the tail end of the longest line early in the race because of a tire getting away on pit road, but he's battled back.
We were told from the pits that Park has much the same package under this car that he had under his Busch car yesterday, and that car was a rocket.
No, it was. He started 38th or so in that race and worked his way up to fight for the lead. Again, Larry, we're hearing week in and week out now with the engine package and the tire situation. Busch Racing seems to be paying off for these guys that are doing double duty.
Well, look at the three cars right there, the 29 of Harvick, the 31 of Skinner, Steve Park, the one, all these guys, they were in that Busch race yesterday.
204 laps complete. Jeff Gordon leads Dale Jarrett by 1 second. It's a further 2 seconds back to Tony Stewart in the MBNA 400 on Fox.
Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by UPS, the official delivery company of NASCAR. We want to race the truck. People love the truck.
Fox welcomes you back to Dover, Delaware. Jeff Gordon leading Dale Jarrett, and you'll want to be with the Fox family of racing networks Friday on Fox Sports Net, qualifying for Winston Cup racing in Michigan at 3 Eastern time. Saturday, the ARCA race at 4 Eastern on Fox Sports Net, and then FX with the final hour of tuning up at 8 Eastern. Note the special time. And then Sunday, as always, NASCAR this morning at 10 Eastern. John Roberts, Derek Cope and the gang. But you'll see the race from Michigan, the Winston Cup race, on FX. And to get FX, a lot of fans calling and writing, very upset because they can't see all the NASCAR races because their cable system doesn't carry FX. Well, the folks understand their frustration and are working hard to change that. You can help with the three more NASCAR races on FX. Not a lot of time here this month, so just call 1-800-FX-FX-FX1. I'll repeat that. There's a lot of FXs there, so follow along. 1-800-FX-FX-FX1, and that'll get you through to your local cable company and tell them, hey, I want my NASCAR, I want my FX, I want my Hollywood Hotel, the guys in the booth, I want my pit reporters, and we don't want you to miss any part of this NASCAR season, and that would include next Sunday at Michigan. We are in Dover, Delaware, 187 laps to go, and it's the battle within the battle. Jeff Gordon leading Dale Jarrett. Of course, Dale Jarrett, the points leader by 75 points as we move into past the one-third point of the Winston Cup season. Over 150,000 people here at Dover. And Jeff Hammond, I want to talk about the driving styles of the two. You know, both Gordon and Jarrett, they've won championships, and they're the big draw in the sport.
Yes, they are, Chris. And what you're seeing here today, I think, is a classical display that, again, Gordon is rebounding last week, and, I mean, he's coming out here with a vengeance. And he's really putting it on the field. And you see Dale Jarrett sitting back there, and I think he's kind of like they're playing a little bit of strategy here. Dale's playing hurt. I think he's just trying to keep Gordon in sight. We still got a long ways to go. I don't think he feels very confident he can stay close to Mr. Yeah. Gordon. He can really win by the end of the day.
Yeah, speaking of Gordon, too, I'd asked him, you know, he has that open wheel background and off of what Tony Stewart did. I said, hey, one day would you like to do that? And he said, no, you know, I appreciate what Tony did doing the double thing, but my focus is on Winston Cup racing, and that focus is showing. It looks like he wants, you know, the points championship lead back or the title back anyway.
I guarantee that young man right there, he wants to be the champion. He feels like he's got people behind him now. They've done it before, but now he's got him a new crew chief in Robbie Loomis, and they're looking to get this young man, and I'm talking about Robbie Loomis, his first Winston Cup championship, and I think they're well on their way.
Talk about the success of Jeff Gordon, and you see that the driver leading the most laps has won 43 of the 62 races, and Gordon has led 202 laps today. And mentioning Dale Jarrett as well, you know, he won in the spring of 98 here in Dover. He's had seven top tens in his last nine starts here in Dover. So two guys running well on a track that they are very comfortable with.
Yeah, and one guy we don't want to forget is the man who's won here recently, and that's Tony Stewart. I've been watching him the last couple of laps here, and he's starting to close in on Dale Jarrett. So there again,
you got to watch out. This race is a long ways from being over.
So it looks to be an exciting finish with some of the biggest names in the sport on the top of the leaderboard. Let's go back upstairs.
Well, before you guys give this race to Jeff Gordon, who has led all but seven laps, and send everybody reaching for the remote control, don't forget, 3 years ago, Gordon led 375 of the 400 laps, but that 88 car won, Dale Jarrett.
He's got a couple of guys that are going to be right after him before the day is over with.
That boy in that Home Depot Pontiac, that 20 car, Tony Stewart, remember, won both races here last year, same race car. He looks like he's headed to the front.
And the reason is because that car is good on the long run. It doesn't fall off that much on the start, but it gets better and better and better as they run along.
And they made major adjustments to that race car a while ago where it would come in a little quicker, wouldn't be quite as loose as long. Matt Yocum, what's going on with our third place car?
Well, gentlemen, both of you are exactly correct. Stewart's car does get better as the run progresses, and they have worked on this race car all day. Right now, the 88 car of Dale Jarrett is reporting in. He's just a little bit loose. It continues to get looser, so he did not want to try to hold up the 20. He just wants to get into his rhythm and wait for the next round of pit stops. Steve Burns.
Well, Matt, we talked a lot about the double duty that Tony Stewart did last weekend. Listen to Joe Gibbs' schedule this weekend. On Thursday, he flew from his home in Charlotte up here to do an appearance for MBNA and then flew back to Charlotte that night. On Friday morning, he flew up here to Salisbury, Maryland to give a speech before coming to Dover to see his son Coy run the truck race. The truck race was rained out, so Joe Gibbs flew back to Charlotte. On Saturday morning, he flew back up here to see Coy finish fifth in the truck race. Then he flew from here to Tampa, Florida to give a speech Saturday night. After the speech, he flew home. This morning, here he is in Dover.
Now, Tony's got to be tired of driving 1,100 miles and Joe picking up all those frequent flyer miles. And That's a tough schedule.
That is the one more tough
schedule. But it's nice to have that phone ring and be in demand.
Yes, but let me tell you, a lot of those things that Coach did, he did because he wanted to. He wasn't being paid. A lot of those things he does, he's a real good, strong Christian guy, and he does a lot of speaking at churches and functions like that.
We are 224 miles into this race. Jeff Gordon has led 217 of them. We've had four caution flags. Two major crashes, a competition yellow to check tires, and Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s harmless spin.
The 66 car, Mike, I've been watching him, and he was up there running pretty good, chasing down Ricky Rudd and a bunch of them, but he took off all at once. Something happened to the car. Maybe Dick Burton can tell us what.
Sure can, D.W. Todd Bodine started in the 39th spot, and you're right, he had gotten himself up to the top 10. But the chassis has gone away. The car has simply gotten tight. Hopefully they can adjust it a little bit better on the next pit stop so he can have a better finish than he's running right now.
Let me show you, when we talk about tight, the car won't turn. That's really that's what it amounts to. The front end just will not grip the racetrack. You go in the corner and you see how high a line you take here. The car just runs up the track, and as it runs up that track, you can't get back in the throttle. Watch the hands. More and more and more and more. You just keep turning left, headed for the fence. Tight, the front hits the wall. Loose, the back hits the wall. Now watch this. Turn, turn, turn. Down into that corner. That's really pretty darn good location for his hands right there. That car is not tight. That's a pretty neutral car. Accelerates up off the corner. He's not fighting with the steering wheel. That car looks pretty comfortable to drive right now to me.
About 8,600 RPM, the end of the straightaway.
And I think one reason his hands look good is he's chasing Todd Bodine in that 66 car for 10th position. Remember, he spun out, brought out our last caution, had to come to pit road, four tires, some adjustments, and he's back fighting to get back in the top 10.
Well, when he spun off of turn four there, I believe he just got behind on his steering, to tell you the truth. Now, that car was coming through, and all of a sudden they just spun around with him. I don't believe he anticipated that. That's the kind of feel that this place will give you.
Jeff Gordon now with a 4.5-second lead over Tony Stewart, who has moved 1 second out in front of Dale Jarrett, the third-place car. Sterling Marlin and Steve Hart complete the top five in front of Harvick, Craven, Skinner, Rudd, and Todd Bodine.
Oh, there's that sound, DW.
Welcome back to Dover Down.
I don't know. I have no idea.
Without exceeding the actual retail amount, what are the most consecutive races that have gone without the pole winner ending up in victory lane?
I don't know.
What do you think, Larry? It's a lot, I know.
Yeah, I'm going to say, I'm going to say 28.
I'm going to say 32.
Both of you wrong.
How about it, Jeff?
It's 29.
You cheated. I know he did. I know he did.
There's no way he knew that. There's no way you knew that one.
I have the great Karnak sitting down here with me, buddy.
Car crash the Magnificent.
Yeah.
From the spring 89 race at Atlanta to the spring 1990 race at Rockingham. And the pole sitter has not won since Tony Stewart did it at Martinsville last October.
Hey, Jeff.
Still say cheap.
Jeff.
Yes, sir.
Have you gotten your ice cream yet?
We already had our strawberries and homemade ice cream earlier. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Guys, one thing I've been noticing right here, we got several cars out here that have got a lot of damage going around to the top group, bottom group, and it's created a lot of issues. The 93 car just about lost it off of turn four that last lap, but the 97 car, just like Gordon trying to pass him right now, they're coming up on these cars so fast, it's almost created some situations that have been kind of dicey.
There's Kenny Schrader. A lot of damage on Schrader's car from that first accident of the day at lap two, and you won't believe who's back in the race. After spending 235 laps fixing that car, number nine, Bill Elliott. Also, Kurt Busch, after crash damage, back out there. Jerry Nadeau coming to pit lane. He's back out with crash damage.
But as a team, when you send your race car back out there, we see a lot of cars at Dover that end up looking this way. You've got to make sure you can maintain good speed. NASCAR makes you maintain a certain speed, but it's the hardest racetrack in the world to get out of the way of other cars.
Oh, yeah, it is. I hate driving a slow car here. It just drives you crazy. You pick up all that debris on your tires, and there goes the 8 car by the 66, and he continues to drop back. Jeff, Todd does. Too many Bogans.
10th place battle, that is. It's more like a skirmish than a battle.
Here's another battle. Steve Park in that one car. This is battling Dale Jarrett for third position.
Man, he is.
Look at him driving there, getting in the corner right here. He's going to pay a little price right here, but boy, not much, DW.
No, he's got a good race car, and he came from nowhere. It's hard to do this race and eat this ice cream all at the same time.
We'll take turns here.
Steve Park has marked
cover for me
from the back to the front, as he did yesterday. Yesterday, they didn't qualify, so that he started in the back, and today he's overcome a penalty for a tire that was rolled from the right front and didn't reach the pit wall and bounced out in front of Johnny Benson.
Man, he is right up under the back bumper of that 88 car, and that is not a comfortable feeling.
Look at him all the way at the bottom of the racetrack here. He's going to make the pass right here. This is a pass for third.
You know why? 88 didn't want him up under the back end of him. They come off turn four. He had him dicing and slicing there a little bit.
And the reason Steve Park and his team was penalized, it was not because Johnny Benson hit the tire. The problem was the tire was out in pit road. Before your car leaves the pit box, all equipment, including tires and wheels, they have to be back at least halfway across the pit box toward the pit wall.
Okay, I'll take over.
My time.
You go.
Pass the hot fudge. Gordon the leader, Tony Stewart 3.8 seconds off the lead.
There Gordon's at the line now. There he goes. And here comes Stewart at the line now.
Stewart trying to three-peat. He won both races last year here at Dover Downs. 244 laps complete in the MBNA 400. Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, Steve Park, Dale Jarrett, Sterling Marlin. The top five, Kevin Harvick edging closer. He's sixth ahead of Ricky Craven, Mike Skinner, Ricky Rudd, and Dale Earnhardt Jr.
The MBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by Original Coors. Nothing beats an original. And by Napa Auto Parts. Napa, we keep America running.
250 laps complete. Dover Downs all-time lap leader is Bobby Allison. 2,800 laps in 35 starts. Jeff Gordon's only started half as many races here, but he's moved up to seventh place on the all-time list.
Oh, there's so many records that he's going to break and rewrite the record book in so many ways if he keeps up the pace he's been on.
Well, Johnny Benson took a huge hit in the points. He came in here fourth, and after that pit road bump, suffered engine failure and is out of the race. Tony Stewart moves way up in the standings.
Boy, that's the phenomenal thing right here. Tony Stewart, just six races ago,
Before Texas, he was 17th in points, so he is chopping away and in a hurry.
You'll see Benson would fall to 8. Earnhardt Jr., Harvick would be in the top 10. Here's what happened to Johnny Benson. Ricky Rudd dodges that pothole, and Johnny Benson pounded it. It came off Steve Park's car. They had to pull off brake ducts, and eventually the engine let go, taking Johnny out of the race.
Like I say, it's really bad, you know, you get beat on the racetrack, or something to that, but when you're going down pit lane and they hit a tire, that started all their trouble right there.
Fourth place, Dale Jarrett being pursued by Sterling Marlin, who has again today been the best of the Dodge boys. Matt?
Right now, Mike, Sterling Marlin's concern is not his loose race car, but his right foot. He's reporting in to team manager Tony Glover and crew chief Lee McCall that his right foot is burning up. Remember, he did have some heat problems at Martinsville as well. Right now, Phil Horton from the Athletic Training Concepts is working on a heat shield protector, much like the heel protectors that drivers wear to help with the heat on their feet. The next pit stop, which should be about lap 272, they are going to pit in. Pass this through the window to Sterling. Tony Glover also told him to try to move around one of the air hoses inside the car to try to get some cooler air to that foot.
That's what that is over there. That's a Nacaduck hose is going through. But folks, watch his hands. Now he's holding a pretty wheel. The car's handling very well, but he's in a turn. Now watch. Look, he's in the neutral position, and look how quickly he's right back in the turn again. Maybe a second or two, he has to relax before he's right back in the turn again. That's how much pressure, how much load, how much work these drivers are doing when it looks like they're just sitting in there on a Sunday ride.
And yes. Even the straightaway here, banked 9 degrees, there's really nowhere that the body gets neutral at this racetrack, is there?
Just look how long he's in the turn. Look how long he's turning the steering wheel. Now look, he's neutral there, just kind of relaxing, and right back at it again.
Yeah, it's a mile racetrack. You're turning those 7/8 of that mile. The car's loaded all the time.
.8 seconds back of this man sits Tony Stewart.
And his foot burning, I mean, it is so painful, and it's so distracting because it takes away from your focus, takes away from your concentration, and it affects your lap times when something starts bothering you.
Steve Park has gotten past Tony Stewart. Park is on a mission. Yesterday and today, all we've seen is Steve Park flying to the front.
Boy, he is, and he has been, and that's great to see. Good for that team, good for him.
See, he's a little bit quicker than our leader, Jeff Gordon.
Steve Park, that lap, the quickest car on the racetrack. 260 laps next time by. Jeff Gordon has led all but 7 of them, but it's far from over here at the Monster Mile. Pit stops coming up in a couple of laps at the MBNA Platinum 400. Here's our race summary. 7 leaders, 9 lead changes. Nobody but Jeff Gordon has led more than 2 laps. 14 cars still on the lead lap, and we've had 4 cautions for 27 laps. 2 major crashes, and the leader coming onto pit road, Jeff Gordon. Steve Park is in as well. Here's Matt.
No adjustments expected for the one car, Steve Park. He's reporting in that his car starts out loose, but it does come in, and it's better on longer runs, so they don't want to make any adjustments on this number one car. Similar characteristics to his Busch car in Saturday's Busch Series race. So see.
Well, Matt, they are going to adjust on the 24 of Jeff Gordon. He's saying it's a little bit tight in the middle and loose off. They talked about making a little wedge adjustment. They're also going to go up on right rear air pressure if Gordon is away.
And a nice move by Bill Elliott's team. They caught the tire rolling in from the right front, handed it off to Gordon's team. Here's Kevin Harvick's stop. Dick Bergeron.
Mike Skinner is in right now. He has complained a lot less on this round about how the car is handling. He says it's a little bit loose, but he can drive it. They're just doing one round of the track. Fire, going to put 2 cans of gas in it, and that's going to be it. Skinner having a better day right now than the way it started. To Matt.
A track bar adjustment for Tony Stewart, but he had trouble entering his pits. He lost 3 or 4 seconds on his entrance. As the guys come around to the left side of the car, Stewart is now finally down and away.
This is Tony Stewart coming into his pits right here. Wants to go in and see Kevin Harvick leaving pit road. We saw that. That's what bit Jeff Gordon last week. Matt Yoakum, how about Tony Stewart?
And the 88 car of Dale Jarrett is in. 4 tires and 1 round down expected on the track bar of Dale Jarrett as they continue to try to dial this race car in. He's down and away.
Tony Stewart back on track. Ricky Rudd is done. Sterling Marlin comes in. Green flag stops.
I tell you, there's just so much pressure on everybody to be fast in the pits. And it seems like it's a contradiction, but here we go. We're going to see if we can get something here for Sterling's foot.
Nope. Drink cup gone. He did take something, but set it down on the floorboard to the side there.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that was all about.
Darrell, I think maybe he'll take that heat shield, and if there's a caution, put it on when he's riding around under caution, but Wood didn't want to take the time to do it then.
Ricky Craven in the 32 car, he's on pit road. He is leading the race, Dick Bergman.
Well, Ricky Craven has had a big day, and why not here at Dover in the Busch Series? He's got a pair of poles. He's been second, third, fifth. This is the same car he finished fifth with at Rockingham earlier this year. Best finish for Craven all year. Best finish ever for his team. A little bit slow on the pit stop. Craven's gone.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. on pit road right in front of the 18 of Bobby Labonte. Right side tires going on in number 8. Jeff Clark, the jackman, has the 8 up. The 18 also getting service. Bobby Labonte saying that that car has been very tight most of the afternoon. Left side tires on the 18. He's also down and away.
Mark Barton coming out with him after making a stop as we cycle through green flag pit stops. And let's again show you the contact between Tony Stewart and Kevin Harvick. Stewart entering, Harvick leaving his pit.
Everybody's in a hurry, green flag pit stops. But again, as a crew chief, I made this mistake many times. It's on your shoulders to talk to that driver. He's in there. He's got headrests, full face helmets. It's on your shoulders. Say, keep it tight. Sometimes you got to say, stop.
One thing that happened there, Harvick couldn't go straight because Stewart's crew was already in his pit. Harvick really couldn't have cut to the left, couldn't cut to the right.
That's another one of those times when some communication between the two pit crews, the cars wouldn't have come in at the same time.
Good point. Any damage? Let's see.
I don't know. Both cars, I don't see any damage on either car, so that's a good deal.
It's a lucky deal.
Matt?
Guys, when the 20 car did pull away, I did get a chance to glance at that left front fender. It looks like there's just a little bit of damage to the left front fender. I don't know how much aero-wise it may disturb the handling of this race car, but it did look like there was a little bit of a crease.
Yeah, you can see it now. It's pushed in just right above the tire there. The tire, it's actually pushed in a little bit, but it's not serious.
Jeff Gordon, the leader. Jason Leffler is the second place car. He has yet, I believe, to make his pit stop. Then Steve Park, Tony Stewart, and Ricky Craven. 275 laps complete at Dover. 280 of 400 laps complete in the MBNA Platinum 400. Jeff Gordon has just put his Hendrick Motorsports teammate Terry Labonte one lap down. That leaves us 15 cars on the lead lap. Tony Stewart there in third behind Gordon and Steve Park.
You know, we talk about teamwork on a pit crew. Now this, again, we had the problem here with Tony Stewart. He comes on in pit road. They're going to perform their 4-tire service. Now you can only have 7 men, but you've seen the 8th man. They give him a windshield service man to pull the windshield off. But Jeff Hammond, what I like is the guy waited until everybody was clear. Then he pulled that fender back out. It's orchestrated. All this is happening under green flag conditions, Jeff.
You've got to be able to do that, Larry. And you know yourself, probably Greg Zipadelli was up there telling the guys, giving them a little bit of encouragement. But hey, we need to get that left front fender out. And you get that left front fender out when you get the tire on. And everybody did their jobs, made the chassis adjustment. They got him in and out, and they took a bad situation and they got through it.
Well, that's what the good teams can do. They don't beat themselves. They don't panic. They stay together. They stay focused on what they got to do, and they get the job done.
That was Tom Dean, the front tire carrier, who reached around to pull that left front fender back out so it wouldn't cause a problem.
Good teams can, they overcome things like that all day long, the good teams do, and that's what makes them good. Other teams, they get in a situation like that and they just fall all to pieces.
And a lot like a line on a football team, the best thing that makes them better is time spent together.
Our 7-Eleven pit summary. Dale Earnhardt Jr. quickest on that exchange.
Boy, I tell you what, he got into the back of 44 coming up off turn four and had him doing the hospital hop, I'm telling you.
More on Earnhardt Jr. Here's Steve.
So, Mike, I went down and talked to Jeff Clark in that number 18. Remember, Dale Earnhardt Jr. spun on lap 177 and didn't hit anything. They made no adjustments on that last stop other than to add tires. Great accomplishment. They're inside the top 10. Dick Bergeron.
So potentially interesting strategy, well developed. Goodyear has determined that there is virtually no drop-off in speed between laps 45 and 75 on the tires. That means short pitting could be a huge advantage.
No adjustments on the 40 car, Sterling Marlin, just an adjustment for the driver. They did pass through the heel protector that Phil Horton had put together for Sterling Marlin to help his burning right foot. Lee McCall, the crew chief, told me Sterling has put it on his foot. We'll have to see how it helps.
That was a real judgment act, I bet you, to take that thing in. He probably put it down in the floor of the car and just maybe pinned it under his foot because he certainly had no time to strap it to anything. That's one of the things that drives the driver crazy. You'll ask for something in the race car, and nobody stops and thinks how confined you are in there. And they hand you all kind of weird bundles, some things, and you look at them like, what am I supposed to do with this?
Next time you're in your passenger car with your seat belts all tightened up, try to tie your shoe.
Yeah, well, or get a bag of ice. Get them to hand you a bag of ice and a Ziploc bag. But the thing is, Ziploc closed, and you got gloves on, you can't get it open.
You know, a guy that had a lucky break earlier, remember, he got his lap back earlier in the race, got back on the lead lap, and he just moved by Todd Bodine for that 11th spot. So he's got a good race car, made that lap up, didn't panic, and he's heading toward the top 10.
Jeremy Mayfield you're talking about.
Yeah, Jeremy Mayfield in the 12.
Good car, and, you know, somebody else that overcome adversity pretty darn good is Mark Martin, who's right there with him. Mark Martin got damage in that, you know, in that first wreck and had trouble, but he stayed on the lead lap, and right now he's in 13th spot.
That's again, quite a move for being as low as 34th in this race.
Good teams overcome adversity. That's what they're good at doing.
There's another one. Bobby Labonte put him in that same category. He's in 14th place, still on the lead lap, as is Elliott Sadler in 15th.
And Bobby is so consistent. He just drives. He runs smooth. He doesn't abuse the car. You don't hear, you don't talk about him. You don't hear about him. But at the end of the day, you look up and you say, how did he get there?
But, Darrell, I talked to his car chief, Butch Hilton, who works under his crew chief, Jimmy Maycar. And I said, you know, you guys had a good run at Charlotte last week. He said, Larry, we have thrown springs and shocks and sway bars all year long. We finally have started working on the front end settings. What the driver feels through his steering wheel. And we thought, we're pretty sure last week at Charlotte, we found what he was looking for. We just hope it transfers to Dover this week. But here's another car, Ricky Craven, that 32 car. I saw him doing this right before the pit stops. He's starting to work the high side. Here he goes by Steve Park. This is for third position. He had one of the fastest race cars on the last part of that green flag run.
And he's about to be the second place car.
Yeah, he is really getting around this racetrack right now. And, of course, Ricky always has run good here. In a Busch car, mostly. I've seen him win here. But he likes this track, and he always has run well here. Today is just an incredible day for OTIDE.
Now look, he's on the bottom of the track. Tony Stewart is running about one groove up higher. One lap ago, 66, Todd Bodine.
That's that insecure, all of a sudden it jumps out from under you feeling it. For me, it always drove me crazy because I never was sure when it was going to do it.
Well, we've seen it all weekend in the Busch race yesterday. Your chassis is a little bit loose. That car, like Mark Martin in the 6, ran up on the back of him, even made him looser, took the rear downforce away from his rear spoiler.
And look at this. He just keeps on coming. The hits just keep on coming. He's going to go up here and just blow by.
And he's been running the high side, but when he needed to, he went right to the bottom of the racetrack.
Put a Linda Ronstadt on him.
And told him, what?
A Linda Ronstadt blew by you.
Oh, my word. Folks, there's only 105 laps of this to go. But Stewart couldn't hold the bottom, and Craven was right down there.
Where do you come up with these?
I don't know.
Do you lay awake at night and think about them?
I had a dream. I had a nightmare. That was when Hammond was working for me. I had nightmares. Now I just have dreams.
You know what? That really hurt to come to you many times you called me in the middle of the night saying, hey, I was thinking. Wake me up out of a sound sleep and tell me what you were thinking.
I'd call him at 3 in the morning and say, Jeff, I've been laying here thinking, and he'd be just about ready to die.
Yeah. So whose nightmare was it?
Wait a minute now.
Tell the truth. Whose nightmare?
I'm just glad you answered. I'd have had to dial 911 if you hadn't.
Guys, right now the nightmare that the field has is this 24 car, Jeff Gordon, 8 seconds ahead of second place Ricky Craven. Even though Ricky's got a fast race car, 8 seconds is a long way to go.
Trying to singe him. Third on back, Stewart, Park, and Jarrett. Third, fourth, fifth.
At least somebody's racing. These guys are having at it right here.
Dale Jarrett in that 88. He's starting to work that high side a little bit. While ago, before the pit stops, Ricky Craven passed him on the high side. Two laps before they pitted, I saw Dale Jarrett move up to the high side.
Well, Ricky Craven's running away from this battle, but he's got a long way to go. 7.7 seconds if he wants to catch Jeff Gordon. Gordon has led 285 of the 299 laps. We're three quarters done here in Dover.
The MBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by Wendy's. Come and celebrate the summer of 99 cents. By Kawasaki. Only Kawasaki all-terrain vehicles offer a unique combination of comfort, reliability, and engineering to handle any riding situation. And by Radio Shack. You've got questions? We've got answers.
Welcome back to Dover. 305 laps complete, and Craven is coming. It was 7.7 seconds, the lead, when we went to break. Now it's down to 6 seconds, so Ricky Craven is doing everything he can to haul down on Jeff Gordon, who has led all but 13 laps today. More on the leader. Here's Steve.
Mike, Jeff Gordon has surely dominated this race, but he just radioed crew chief Robbie Loomis and said, my car is too tight right now, and he has continually said that the car especially tight in traffic. Let's go to Dick.
A year ago, a lot of people thought Ricky Craven was all washed up, the victim of a whole bunch of injuries he had suffered in stock car racing crashes. But over the wintertime, Cal Wells, team owner of the number 32 car, stuck his neck out, hired Craven, thought he was going to be okay, and today Craven is proving him right. The car that they are running so well with today is their own. It's a PPI car that this team built from the ground up. Tonight.
Dick, I spoke with Ricky Craven this week, and they felt very confident after the final practice session. But Ricky told me what they're really concerning themselves with is the final 22-lap run to the season conclusion. He said that many people do not realize that most of the guys that worked in the 32-car team last year have moved over to Andy Hughes' number 96 team. Not only is he trying to work on chemistry and gelling with crew chief Mike Beam, but this entire team is trying to work together and get their chemistry together to try to make a run, to try to get themselves higher in points, to make a better run next year.
And you want to see how hard this cat's driving? Watch this. Going down in the corner, got the wrecked car, and they do up on the outside, and he drives it down in there and says, get out of my way. And there he goes on his merry way.
By Kurt Busch in the 97 car as well.
Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt Jr. took a spot from Sterling Marlin. They were running nose to tail. Harvick, Marlin, and Earnhardt Jr. And Marlin got loose off turn two. Dale Jr. drove under and drove by.
The track's slick enough, and we're at a place now in the race where if somebody gets right up behind you, puts that nose right up under your back bumper, pretty good chance it's going to loosen you up pretty significantly. Enough to where you're going to yield. You're going to say, please go on.
That moves the eight car up to eighth place.
And again, with that foot burning, that heel burning in the 40 car there with Sterling, he doesn't want to have to be distracted any further, so he just wants to be by himself.
Tony Stewart coming back on the bottom as Steve Park starts to climb the hill. Meanwhile, Jeff Gordon's lead over Craven is now down to 5.2 seconds.
This is a battle for fourth right here between Steve Park and Tony Stewart.
Well, and at this racetrack, it can change, and you better be on top of it. You better be changing with it.
Back at 12th place, Bobby Labonte takes 12th from Jeremy Mayfield.
I believe one thing that maybe Labonte looked in his mirror, or at least his spotter's telling him, you're on the same straightaway. He's going into turn three. Jeff Gordon's on the same straightaway with the leader here, and you better get going, bud.
Got a little thank you wave out the window.
I love it. That's something drivers don't do enough, I think. You know, they kind of got to wave until they got appreciated.
There's your leader at the line right now, Jeff Gordon, in that 24 car. These guys know they don't need to be racing each other.
There's
right
Craven
now
at the line, so he has definitely chopped that gap down considerably. Gordon was so far out there, I mean, I was beginning to think no one could catch him.
You're right. If you're going to acknowledge a driver when he does you wrong, you should acknowledge when one does you a favor.
A little friendly wave. I'll never forget David Pearson and Richard and all those guys. When you'd race them or they'd race you, they'd always, when you pull over and let them go, they'd give you a little thank you. They don't seem to be giving you those thank yous anymore.
Battle for eighth right here. Kevin Harvick in the 29. Sterling Marlin in the 40 car. Again, a battle for eight. Jeff Hammond, we're on pit road about 30 laps to go. We've got about 85 laps to go. I'm gonna maybe think about short pit, and I don't think I'm going to think about two tires because of this hard tire. The left sides are wearing two. What's your thinking?
I'm like you, Larry. I think you need to get four tires. But what's going to be critical is what we saw a minute ago with the 20 car. These guys will be coming in with green flag stops. You don't want to have to be contending with somebody that's going to be just in front of you or just behind you, worried about whether they're going to run over you coming in or going out. So who gets on and off pit road could have a big bearing on who maybe has a chance to catch a 24 or at least run in second today.
Yeah, I mean, the real problem is in those first five pits, Jarrett, Stewart, Marlin, Harvick, and Park all running at the front. As we see Steve Park battling Dale Jarrett here for third, those guys need to communicate and try not to be on pit road at the same time, especially if you're pitted right beside one another.
Yeah, and that used to really upset me because I'd ask my crew, he'd say pit next time, and I'd be in a pit with someone else. I'd say, why did you wait one more lap? And of course, Jeff would always give me one of those. I had no ideas, but.
Well, sometimes you wouldn't listen and come in when I called you the first time.
Well, it wasn't time to come in.
83 to go. Steve Park moves into third ahead of Dale Jarrett. And what messed that all up on the last sequence was the leader and fastest car on the racetrack, Jeff Gordon, pitted first. And everybody else felt they had to come in right away if they were going to keep pace with Gordon with new tires.
And you always depend on these people. They're your eyes in the sky at Dover.
We're inside the window of a full fuel run, so how much fuel will you need on that last stop, and how much time will it take to get it in?
Well, I think the gas man is going to be important, but one of his big roles is these guys can run about 80, 85 laps on fuel, as we saw at the beginning of the show. Most of them are going to be on pit road about 50 to go. Yeah, you got to make sure you get a can and then some in there, but you want to be out of the way of your tire changers, not getting in the way of that man coming around from the right rear to the left rear, but still do your job as well.
Steve Park running third. Matt, is there a problem?
Steve Park is reporting in the car has developed a miss. They believe the battery is dead on the car that is currently running in the third place. It appears problems has begun to develop on the one car.
Well, he can, you know, right at this point, you got 75 laps to go. Turn all the blowers off, turn the fans off, and it'll probably make it. It's going to be marginal.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of electrical needs on these race cars. You'll have a blower on the rear end cooler. You'll have a blower on the radiator, electric fan. You'll have blowers on the driver. DW, the first thing you cut off,
blowers on the driver. I know. Well, you tell them you turn that one off, but you don't turn it off till you have to.
Speeds at the line. You see Craven, who keeps closing in, is fastest. Craven has closed to within 4.4 seconds of Jeff Gordon.
And he continues to chop that down. Gordon's not getting through traffic quite as easily as he once was, and he's in a lot of it.
You know, I saw the Cat in the Hat just go into Mark Martin's pit, and Mark was the fastest car on the racetrack that lap.
And he has moved into the top 10. He's in 10th position.
Andy Houston to go two down, and there is Mark.
And look at that old beat-up thing. Got tape all over the front end of it, but he has driven the wheels off of it.
The Cat in the Hat is Jack Roush, Martin's car owner.
It's not unusual to see Mark Martin run well here at Dover. This is a track that he always runs well, and he's doing it again today with that old beat-up race car he's got.
I asked him, you know, good run for him at Charlotte last week. I said, hey, Mark, this same car you had at Charlotte? He said, no, this is a car we ran at Bristol a few weeks ago. Sat on the pole up there, so it's a car that he likes, and as you say, he likes Dover, Delaware.
Yeah, it could be a concrete car, you know. Now, folks, that doesn't mean it's made out of concrete, but some of these teams have cars that they like to run at Bristol and here, and they call them concrete cars, and there's a sundry of reasons why, and some of them make sense, some of them don't.
The leaders figuring out when they will pit. We'll find out when we come back to the MBNA Platinum 400.
The MBNA Platinum 400 on Fox is brought to you by MBNA, issuer of the official NASCAR credit card. Log on, MBNA.com. By Craftsman, the official tools of NASCAR, CART and NHRA. By KFC. And by Dodge, and nearly 3,000 dealers who invite you to come see what's different.
Mark Martin has passed Kevin Harvick for ninth place. That's the only change in the top 10 with Jeff Gordon's lead over Ricky Craven. Cut to 3.4 seconds. Let's get some pit strategy with Steve.
Well, Mike, we have not heard Robbie Loomis say yet to his driver, Jeff Gordon, what he wants to do, but we did hear Jeff Gordon confirm what Darrell Waltrip was saying, and that is he cannot drive the car on the bottom, he can't drive it on the top, and it's still tight in traffic. Matt Yoakum.
Down here in the one pit, Steve Burns. The battery, Steve Parker's reporting in that they have, there's the battery, he's reporting in that he's turned off all the blows, the mist has gone away, but the alternator is not charging. They also have a spare alternator back here in the pit box just in case.
Now, unlike your battery in your passenger car, the battery is behind the left rear tire. That's where NASCAR says it has to be. This right here, that'll what's let them change it in a hurry. It's a quick disconnect. They'll take the left rear tire off, pull a little aluminum door off, slide that battery out, slide this one in, and the quick disconnect is actually up right behind the driver, so you can connect it and secure it at the same time.
Park continues in third place. He's about 1.2 seconds ahead of Dale Jarrett. Now here is Jeff Gordon and Ricky Craven. Since his fifth place finish at Rockingham, he's only had two top 20 finishes. His best run at Dover, 13th back in 1997. There's Craven, who is closing it down on the leader.
He is closing. And remember, we're about 10, 15 laps away from a pit stop. Mike Beam, Ricky Craven's crew chief. What he's got to do, he's got to talk to that driver. He's got to say, hit your mark coming in the pits on this pit stop. Get all you can, no speed, and come to your pit box. And he's going around to each one of those crew members. Guys, no mistakes, no mistakes.
Yeah, 14.5 would be great, but a 15.5 with no mistakes would be a lot better than trying to do a 14.5 and have trouble.
That's Mike Bemis, crew chief, been around the sport for a long time. Harry Gant days, Butch Lindley days. He's been around a long time.
He worked up at Juniors with us at one time.
Nicknamed Peanut.
With Richard Petty, with Bill Elliott.
With Bill Elliott for quite a while, yes.
Yep. 3.2 seconds is the gap from Gordon back to Ricky Craven. Jeff Gordon likes to lead here. In 95, he led 400 laps. The race was 500 laps long then. In 96, he led over 300 laps. 96 in September, over 200 laps. And in 1998, he led 375 of the 400 laps.
And could you imagine, Mike, I mean, we're coming up to the 350 mark here just shortly, if there was another 100 laps to go on top of this? And that's what it was up to a couple of years ago.
All right, green flag stops have started. Kevin Harvick in the 29. He commits to pit road first. Come to the attention of that Goodrich crew.
Jeremy Mayfield's in as well.
This race was affectionately known as the 24 Hours of Dover back in those days. This is a much better race.
Four-tire stop for the Goodrich car. Matt Yoakum.
Ronnie Atto and company have already gone around to the left side of this car. A slight air pressure adjustment on the 29. 15.6 seconds, and he is down and away.
That car took one can and a splash, and that was it.
That's it. Again, we can run about 85, 90 laps, and we've got right now about 55 to go. You just needed part of one can and the other part of the whole can of the other. The best friend that Ricky Craven's got right now is Todd Bodine in that 66. Probably not for long, but he's trying to stay on the lead lap. He's in 12th position. So right now, Jeff Gordon has put all but the 11 cars on the lead lap.
Rusty Wallace, trouble continues. He'd made his last stop of the day and had to come back in to repair something.
So he's back out on the racetrack, but well off the pace, some three laps down now.
I know Rusty probably would not necessarily agree with me, but he is another one of those guys that hadn't fared quite so well here at Dover since it's become concrete as he did back when his thing was asphalt.
Outside.
He was a very dominant driver on the asphalt. Seems like he struggled a little bit more with it being concrete.
Outside.
Just getting back up to speed now after that second stop. 3 seconds. Jeff Gordon's lead has stabilized over Ricky Craven, at least for the moment. Steve Park, Dale Jarrett, Tony Stewart, the top five. Stewart trying for the three-peat here at Dover. Mike Skinner, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Sterling Marlin, Mark Martin, Ricky Rudd, Bobby Labonte, Todd Bodine, and Terry Labonte still hanging on to the lead lap here.
Well, the good thing right now, or the thing that most of these guys that are on the lead lap have got to be thinking about is, I don't want to pit if I can help it before Gordon does.
And Todd,
they would go way down if they did.
Todd Bodine in the 66 just went a lap down to Jeff Gordon. Not a bad move. He's come to pit road for his four tire. See if he can try to get some advantage here, maybe come back out in front of Gordon after the green flag pit stop cycle.
And he could do that by pitting ahead of Gordon and by having new, faster tires. His lap times these next few laps should be quicker than Gordon's before Gordon pits.
Who just went by, so that's another lap. And now Todd is slowly 35 miles an hour headed down pit lane.
Now the worst nightmare for Todd Bodine, Jeremy Mayfield, Kevin Harvick in this little window right here, should a caution flag come out and burn him.
Yeah, that's the thing. You hate to pit before that leader does, because he's going to dictate if somebody's going to go a lap or more down.
And there are 51 laps to go as Gordon crosses the line.
Not a major adjustment.
Gordon calling for just an air pressure change.
Yeah, no major adjustments.
Terry Labonte in the 5 car, Jeff Gordon's teammate, Kellogg's car, he's on pit road.
He had just gone a lap down in 13th place. Could you imagine the NFL? I mean, the coaches can talk to quarterbacks. There are speakers in their ears as they set up the plays. But could you imagine as he's rolling right to have the coach in your ear going, no, no, go left. No, no, car high. Lineman high. Linebacker low. Could you imagine all that going on in your ear in any other sport?
Well, I think they were headed that way with the XFL, but that fell apart. So,
yeah. All right, our leader, Jeff Gordon, in the 24 car. He's on pit road.
You did hear him seconds ago say, let's not make a major adjustment. They're going to put one pound of air in the right rear tire. They had talked about making a wedge adjustment. It does not appear that they're going to do that. Right side tire is going on. Remember, just an air pressure on the 24. They come around to the left side. Lug nuts are off the left side tires. Good stop for Jeff Gordon. 14.4 seconds.
Dale Jarrett at the bottom of your screen getting his service as Gordon goes out.
Larry, how would you like to have the fastest car on the racetrack and do a 14-4 pit stop?
And that's the confidence he has. He knows for the most part when he comes to pit road, he's going to have a fast stop.
Park, Rudd, and Stewart are in. So is Skinner, Bobby Labonte, and John Andretti.
That's what you call relentless. They just don't let up on you.
Matt.
The 20 car of Tony Stewart is in. His car was tight, tight, tight. The one car is down and away. He was loose. They adjusted with wedge. The 20 car is now down and away.
Craven is in now. He had assumed the lead. Dick Bergeron.
The most important pit stop of 35-year-old Ricky Craven's entire career. They have got to get it right. The crew patting each other on the back before it went off. Jim Carver, the front tire carrier, just dropped down the pit road and did about a dozen push-ups. Behind the wheel. This crew has got to do this flawlessly, perfectly. They can win the race for him, or they can lose it right here. Slow on the left front. 18.9. Not the best stop. Right there, over 4.5 seconds difference in pit stop alone. We'll see Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the Budweiser car he's in.
The right front tire changer just had a terrible time. He liked to never got the right front tire back on.
Kenny Wallace in as well as green flag. Pit stops continue with 45 laps to go. Four tire change for Earnhardt Jr. And Mark Martin has picked up the lead.
Can you believe that?
Didn't know if it had ever happened, but Martin has now led every race this year.
And here he comes down pit lane right now.
That 70 bonus points could mean a big difference at the end of the day, come the end of the season.
Make sure you guys bring these tires back. Mark, you're about 10 away right there.
That's Jimmy Fennec, crew chief.
About 5 away right here, guys.
Jimmy Finn and his crew chief, you got to talk to that driver. You got to talk to him the whole time.
44 laps to run. And Gordon will reassume the lead after this round of green flag stop.
But the real loser, Ricky Craven in the 32 car. Remember, before the stop, 3 seconds. He's almost 11 seconds behind Jeff Gordon now. 45 laps to go. He can't get there. He just cannot get there.
5 of those seconds lost on the longer pit stop, but much of the rest lost because Jeff Gordon is so good getting into the pits fast and getting out of the pits fast.
What a difference these guys can make right here.
43 laps to go at Dover. A crash down the front straightaway has put us under the fifth caution of the day, and Ron Hornaday ends up in the infield grass.
Yeah, he and Park was coming up on him, and Park was so much faster, and Park got into him, and he did a whale of a job of not causing a huge wreck. Watch this. I think Park starts to go around him. 14 car moves up in front of him a little bit, looked like. I think he might have thought that he was going to try to duck underneath of him going down in the corner and started to the outside. Park was there.
Well, is the left rear down on Hornaday's car there, or is it just the way it looks to me, Darrell? The way that car just slewed.
Let's see if we can tell anything here, but it just kind of looks like. Oh yeah, it turns. It turns. Good call,
Jeff Hammond.
Yes, look at it again, guys. You'll notice. I believe the rear track bar broke on that car coming off the corner. If you'll notice, all of a sudden the rear end goes out from underneath the car and then back the other way and it's sitting down in field. The rear end is caught. Rear track bar, I believe, broke on the 14 car.
Tough break for Ron Hornaday, who was as high as ninth in this race.
They got a few guys that are going to duck back into pits here, the 32, the 20, and the 31. These guys are going to get on 4 more tires, Larry.
So is Rudd, Harvick, and Marlin, leaving Jeff Gordon out there not quite by his lonesome.
I tell you who's the big loser, I believe, in this deal. It's Mark Martin. You know, he only took 2 tires for track position, and now the caution really hurts him because everybody's going to have 4 tires, and so far he stayed out.
The cars that stayed out are Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin on the lead lap, and Mark Martin, Mayfield there.
We're hearing that Mike Skinner in the 31 is being held for 15 seconds. A tire got away. Again, the tire has to be back across right there before you can leave. All the equipment has to be back across there before you can leave pit road.
Let's look at this again. And, of course, I saw the car turn suddenly to the right, but I thought he was trying to get out of Park's way. But, actually, like Jeff said, I think the track bar must have broken.
Definitely something broke
there.
Right,
you go.
There.
Yeah. I thought he had been told by maybe Park. The drivers will do it all the time. They'll say, give me the inside. I thought he might have been trying to get up out of his way.
All right, we want to explain to you what a track bar is. This is a track bar. It's hooked to the trailing arm on the left side right here with this rod in. It's hooked to the frame. The track bar is always in a tremendous load here, and a lot of times one of these joints will break or pull out of the track bar itself.
So we're under caution with 36 laps to go. Now Mayfield comes to pit road. This changes everything. Yesterday, Jimmy Spencer won the Busch race. Jeff Green, the point leader, had trouble, so Kevin Harvick is the new leader in NASCAR's Busch Series. Scott Riggs won the truck race, so Craftsman presents the point standings after 8 races. Scott Riggs with a healthy lead over Joe Ruttman and Jack Sprague.
And we're getting ready to, speaking of healthy, we've got a healthy little restart here.
34 laps to go. Rusty Wallace in that 2 car, 3 laps down. Like to get one of his lap back. Remember, Mark Martin in the 6 car right there took 2 tires on the green, stayed out right here.
Oh, Robert Presley slid up in front of Dale Jarrett. And that Jarrett a chance to stay with the front
car. Bottlenecked everything up when he did that. Big break for Jeff Gordon because there's some cars in there maybe that could keep up with him now that they've got 4 fresh tires on.
I say maybe. It's pretty doubtful. That guy's been awesome today.
Rusty Wallace is three laps down. Remember, he had to make an extra pit stop in this last green flag cycle, and he's right between leader Jeff Gordon and second place Mark Martin. Steve?
And Jeff Gordon and Robbie Loomis discussed briefly the merits of pitting. Jeff said, let's stay out. I like the air pressures, the way the tires feel. So really, they didn't even think twice. They stayed out. Dick?
Martin and Jimmy Pettig talked a lot about whether they should bring that number six car in for a pit stop or not. On the last caution flag, Mark, after all, took just two right side tires on that automobile. They're not sure if the thing is going to be fast or not, but they rolled the dice for track position.
And the die is cast for Mark Martin.
Well, so far, so good. And all these lap cars really bottlenecked everything up for some of these fast guys with four tires. So the longer they go, the better off you'll be.
Now watch 32 Ricky Craven in the midst of that bottleneck there with
all the way on the apron.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a lap down car. And watch what 66 does to Bobby Labonte. Watch. Well, we didn't stay out long enough. He come right down across the bow of him and about took him out.
Tony Stewart, after this restart, finds himself in seventh. Matt?
Earlier this afternoon, Tony Stewart's car was very loose. Now it's gone to the opposite end of the spectrum. Now it is tight. The last two pit stops, they have taken 1.5 rounds of wedge out trying to loosen this race car up.
He's 3.7 seconds off the lead with 28 laps to go.
I don't believe you can stop the race and let everybody work on their car and they can keep up with Jeff Gordon. He is just, he's awesome today. One of those days, Larry.
When you hit it, you hit it. It's your day.
And this is that kind of racetrack. If you get it right, you're going to make everybody else look pretty bad.
In 1995, Gordon started second and led 400 of the 500 laps en route to an easy win. Started second again today.
Be sure that we write that down.
You mean every time he starts second, you should pick him?
Yeah, that's right. He should pick you.
Yeah, I'm about a week late on my pick, I think.
It will reflect in your standings. Larry, don't worry.
Yeah, that's what I was afraid of. But I'm still not sure what we're going to win.
Put a nice note in with your check, Larry. How about Jason Leffler? First trip to Dover Downs, got himself back on the lead lap where he sits in 13th place. That young man's having quite a day.
And it will be such a confidence booster for this whole group. Of course, he's Sterling Marlin's teammate, driving for Chip Ganassi.
Yeah, and both those cars have run very well. You just see Mark Martin just slide up out of the way and let these guys with four tires go. He knows he's pretty well. He's dog meat now.
It wasn't a bad move until the caution came out.
No, that would have probably paid off had it stayed green.
Yep, here come all these cars with fresh tires like Earnhardt Jr. and Mayfield. And Mark Martin, who got close and who led three laps of this race, but it appears will not win it if we stay green these final 25 laps.
Ricky Craven in the 32, he goes underneath Jeremy Mayfield.
And boy, that car still is running great. I mean, it's handling good, it's running good. Just a shame what happened to him in the pits. And Jeremy Mayfield way off the pace right behind him there. Looks like he may have a flat tire. He can't get down, there's oncoming traffic.
Jeff Gordon and Ricky Craven are the only cars lapping under 24.7 seconds. Oops, add Earnhardt Jr. to the lap list. He's the fastest car on the racetrack.
Jeremy Mayfield continues to idle along on the outside right here. He can't get down to the inside. Too many cars.
Earnhardt Jr. in fourth, working over Dale Jarrett.
Right to the bottom of the racetrack. Back in that throttle. Boy, beat Dale Jarrett back to the throttle off the corner right here.
And, man, I'm telling you, when somebody is tucked up under you like that, it'll just make you draw up. Even up here, it makes me draw up.
Look at Earnhardt Jr. back to the throttle so much earlier than Dale Jarrett in the 88 car beats him off the corner.
Here,
no
voice,
substitute
your voice
time on the throttle.
Drew up like Linda Ronstadt right just here, talking about it.
That's right.
22 laps to go on the Monster Mile. Jeff Gordon for now in command by 0.6 seconds. NBA Platinum 400. Jeff Gordon's lead over Steve Park now at 3/4 of a second. Dale Earnhardt Jr. closing But he may run out of time. He's 3.2 seconds back.
These two cars right here, though, they're about the same speed right now.
They really are. The fastest car is the 32 car, but he's too far back. But, man, I tell you, Park is, he is doing all he can. And I don't think it, he can get up there and race Gordon. Gordon's probably keeping him at bay, but still, it's a good run for Park. You can see he's driving the wheels off of it.
Ricky Rudd's been trying to get under Tony Stewart for the last four laps. And he does for eighth place.
Kevin Harvick in that 29 car. He's going to pull to the inside. He wants to take the position as well.
Well, Stewart holds Rudd off, and Rudd skips up the hill just a bit.
Mike Skinner in the 31 car right behind this group, remember, had the pit road penalty. 15 seconds had to be started the last car on the lead lap. He's fought his way back to 11.
Boy, Harvick's car is so quick through the center of the corner. That old Ford seems to pull down the straightaway a little harder.
13 to go. Tony Stewart, it appears, will not repeat at Dover.
Hard to do, man.
David Pearson did it in 73, made up a lap. While the Wood Brothers made up a lap after he hit a spinning car, and the Wood Brothers repaired it. He won a shootout between he and Bobby Allison and Buddy Baker to win three in a row.
Boy, this is good close racing right here. Maybe too close. Harvick and Rudd, and there's a Skinner. And we know that Skinner would like to finish ahead of Harvick at all possible.
Now Tony Stewart has run off and left this group.
Mark kind of caught his breath on those two tires and let everybody right there on him get away from him, and he's hanging on.
Tony Stewart right here in the number 20 car, Home Depot car, chasing after Mark Martin in that six car. Matt Yoakum, how about Tony Stewart?
Well, Tony Stewart has pulled away from Ricky Rudd, but he came on the radio a few short laps ago, Larry, and said the car is just getting worse. There's nothing I can do with it. I'm just going to get what I can get.
Jeremy Mayfield's gone to the garage, only the seventh driver to exit this race. 10 to go. And Gordon, those flames are shooting out a little longer, Darrell. He's upped it to 1.1 seconds over Steve Park.
Those flames are running all the way back down the straightaway right now.
Hendrick Motorsports has won six races at Dover with four different drivers. Three for Gordon, Jeff Bodine, Ricky Rudd, and Ken Schrader have also won here for Rick Hendrick.
Well, I tell you, the fastest car on the racetrack, Dale Earnhardt Jr., that other DEI car, number eight car there, he's about a tenth and a half faster than Jeff Gordon. Problem is, 2 3/4 seconds and only nine laps to go. There you see, last lap speed, over a mile an hour faster than Jeff Gordon, but again, nine laps to go, eight laps next time by.
My hero for the day, Ricky Craven. That's my hero. He has driven the wheels off of that car today, and he's going to finish fourth here, looks like. That's a heck of a good run for that young man. That car is still digging, boys.
And he had a shot to win it, but a pit stop much longer than Jeff Gordon's under green is what cost Craven a shot to be contending for the lead with eight laps to go.
Pretty hard to compete with a fast car and a 14 and a half second pit stop for anybody.
Even with the caution.
Yeah, even with the caution. Like I said, I don't believe he can stop the race. They work on him and keep up with him today.
Jeff Gordon, these six laps to go next time. A little bit of lap traffic in front of him. Could be a factor. Stacy Compton up there. Let's look at the speeds at the line.
Park just a teeny bit quicker.
Craven the
look
fastest.
At Craven. Boy, is that, that doesn't break your heart.
Ricky Craven, the fastest of all our lead lap cars.
That's why we call this a team sport. Everybody has to do their job. Got to have a fast car, a great driver. Got to make those quick stops.
It'll break your heart, Darrell. The fourth place still pays pretty well.
Oh, it does. I mean, he'll be happy. That's a big step up from what they did since back there at Rockingham.
Dale Jarrett was not expected to contend here, but he's been up in the top five most of the day. Currently riding fifth. Remember, rib problem from that Charlotte qualifying crash. Still bothering Jarrett, but you wouldn't know it to look at his performance. He's in the top five and won't lose a lot of points to Jeff Gordon today.
Good top five finish. That's all he needed coming in here with his problem, so he got it.
Johnny Benson will fall out of the top five. They succumbed to motor failure. Jeff Gordon has led 377 laps. He's got to lead four more. And that will top the record. Mark Martin led 379 of 400 here in 1998. Gordon is on pace to best that by two. And last year, he didn't lead at all.
He's making up for lost time, Mike. I can tell you that.
Hey, but Park is coming. Steve Park has cut it down to 0.6 seconds.
But yeah, there was a little more traffic. I'm sorry, Larry, go ahead.
It's okay. I was just going to say the real battle is back there for seventh with Mark Martin, Tony Stewart, Ricky Rudd, Kevin Harvick, and Mike Skinner. There you see again, Mark Martin, the victim, I think, of two right side tires.
Oh, boy.
Him and Rudd get together right there at the start finish line. Kevin Harvick's going to take advantage of it. Mike Skinner in the 31, he's wanting to get in there as well.
Boy, Mark just was holding the... Rudd up, and Rudd got a nose up under him coming off, and Mark cut him off.
White flag, and it couldn't come any sooner for Jeff Gordon. Steve Park has closed in to try to make a race out of this 0.7 seconds back.
He has a clear racetrack for another half a mile. No lap traffic should be a factor.
And Park, wishing this race was 5 laps longer, draws within about 8 car lengths in turn 4, but Jeff Gordon comes off the fourth corner and gets his 54th career victory. Meanwhile, Martin and Rudd battle off turn number 4.
If they don't wreck each other, it's going to surprise me. They have been into each other. Martin did a great job of hanging on.
Martin will take the position.
9th place.
I don't know if that's friendly. Congratulations.
Oh, I think it is. Oh, yeah. I saw teammates do that. Well, they're not teammates, but I've seen guys do that before.
Jeff Gordon's win ties him with Lee Petty and Rusty Wallace for 7th on the all-time NASCAR list. It's his 4th win at Dover, his 2nd win of the season, and he led all but 19 laps. Jeff Gordon today with a thoroughly dominating performance. He led 381 of 400 laps, and he sits in the MBNA winner's circle here at Dover Downs for his 2nd win of the season. Steve Burns is with him.
Thank you, Mike. Jeff Gordon accepting congratulations from his wife, Brooke. Jeff, boy, that was a flat, dominant performance by you and this race team.
I tell you what, that was incredible. I wasn't expecting that today. You know, just felt like DuPont 24 Chevrolet of the old here at Dover. And I think, you know, a lot of it is this tire that Goodyear has. I think it just brings some of our old setups back to us. The track, you know, just like it used to be for us. But these guys, they really had it hooked up today. And oh man, I just you know, want to thank God for a great day, a safe day. And you know, this one's for DuPont. They're up here in Wilmington. We went to visit with all their folks on Thursday, and they got a lot of customers that come to every race. And this one right here is for you guys. Thank you for everything you do, DuPont.
All right, great victory. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
And Steve Park finished a career best 2nd here at Dover. Were you catching him, or was he just playing with you?
I don't know, man. Jeff Gordon, he's a hell of a race car driver, and my hat's off to those guys. We had a good race car, and at times we were catching them, and at times we weren't. So I started overdriving the car trying to catch them and started losing ground. And once I settled back down, I was able to reel them back in again. But, man, that Pennzoil Chevrolet was a good race car. We just had that tire come across pit road and put us behind. So to rally back from that just shows that we got a great race team with Paul Andrews and Bono and all the guys.
A great top two finish, the 4th time this year for Steve Park. Dick?
We'll try to get back to Dick Bergeron in a moment. Technical difficulties as he stands with Ricky Craven.
Yeah, we got to talk to Ricky Craven. We got to talk to him.
Matt?
Dale Earnhardt Jr., great come from the back. Great run for you today.
Yeah, it was. We had a good car. Really wasn't great. And got real loose about midway through the race. And it spun out down the front straight away. And somehow kept it off the wall. It was just all luck there. But we made some adjustments after that. I think that kind of proved to us that we really need to work on the car, and we finally worked on the car and got tightened up, and it was probably about the quickest thing out there at the end. We just ran out of laps.
A great day for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated.
Let's show you our Chevy winning moment. Jeff Gordon is the winner, and Chevy congratulates Jeff, and the number 24 Monte Carlo on the big win. This was the only on-track pass for the lead all day.
It's the only winning moment.
It was several hours ago.
Rusty Wallace got in front for one lap, and Gordon passed him right back. More champions depend on Chevy. Will be there. As you have a look through the results today with Jeff Gordon, a big, big win.
Sterling Marlin, sixth place. Good run for him. Kevin Harvick ended up eighth.
Tony Stewart trying to three-peat, ends up seventh with an ill-handling car the last 100 laps.
I still, Craven's my man, guys. I'm impressed with that run today.
Well, my hero of the day, Jason Leffler, 13th, finished on the lead lap. First time he'd been here in a Cup car.
Oh, that is. That's a great run for him, too.
Casey Atwood in that early crash, still hurting from last week.
See the guys that were in those crashes early on, Jimmy Spencer, Nadeau, Kurt Busch, Bill Elliott.
Yeah, most of them got back on track. Let's go back to Dick with Ricky Craven.
At Matt Yoakum's microphone, my hero of the day is right here. Ricky Craven, you proved today you can get the job done. Were you thinking about your victory speech during some of those laps?
Shame on me, right? But I was. And I'm not going to tell you everything I was thinking, but I'm going to share a little bit with you that if I had gotten to victory lane, I would have thanked Tide. I would have thanked Cal Wells, all these team members, because they took a chance and they pulled me off the disabled list, so to speak, and put me in a car. And, man, we've just run great all year. We haven't had the results to show for it, but we've had some strong runs, and today was great. And I just want to say thank you to everybody in New England, everybody that's helped me along the way. That's just a little bit of what I'm going to say when we get to victory lane.
And you're going to get your chance at it, I'm sure.
All right, thank you very much. Jeff Gordon's win inches a little bit closer as he moves up on Dale Jarrett, but a gutsy performance, or a ribsy, if you want to word it that way. Dale Jarrett with that sore rib on the right side, finishing fifth, and Rusty Wallace third. So, Jeff Hammond, let's talk about this. For a guy like Jeff Gordon, who averaged, 10 victories over the previous four seasons, only had three last year. We say only for a guy who set standards as high as he did, but he wins his second race this year. Looks like Jeff Gordon has returned to that championship form.
Absolutely, Chris. I think right now you got to take in consideration that there's so much right now going on behind the scenes at Hendrick Motorsports. There's a lot of things that have been developed and worked on. These guys have got it turned around. The chemistry between Robbie Loomis and Jeff Gordon is now very evident. You got to watch out for these guys.
And the Monster Mile did the Monster Mash when we began things at Dover Downs International Speedway today. After a lot of rain leading up to this, it was clear skies and pretty much clear sailing for Jeff Gordon. After we got through some of this, there were botched pit stops, flying tires, no three-peat for Tony Stewart. The Flames DuPont car was on fire. Jeff Gordon cementing the win on the concrete early, inching closer to Dale Jarrett in the points chase, which will continue next week in Michigan on FX.